What up, bros? Welcome to another BroGraph Brocast. I'm Dave.
And I'm Matt.
And I'm David. Are you going to the store?
This is BroCast number 70.
Oh, yeah, we hit the big 7-0. That feels pretty good. Feels good, bro.
We're going to have to do something cool.
Feels good, bro.
I know. We'll have to do something for the big 100. We'll see. Mm-hmm. But we do the annual look into the 10 years into the future episode, and that's going to be episode 104, you know, or
so
around
stupid.
There. No, jeez. It is the best.
It's so stupid.
Yeah,
I mean, it was amazingly stupid, like in a good way.
So, I don't know. So maybe we should, maybe we should just go like super. Maybe episode 100, we should do another 10-year look into the future. I don't know.
So if you're just joining us for the first time.
None of this made any sense whatsoever.
Right. BroGraph, it's a supplement to our site, BroGraph.com. It's a motion graphics site with tutorials and plugins and podcasts and MoGraph stuff. And on the show, we talk about motion graphics and Cinema 4D, After Effects plugins, render engines, doing business, doing taxes, being a contractor, and working for the man. So this week, we're just chilling out. We've got the Super Bowl coming up. And David, we didn't mention, he is actually here with me.
I'm in Texas.
Yeah.
I'm in Texas.
In the studio.
In studio.
Your
I've been
studio,
eating lots
not
of
mine.
Cheeseburgers and Whataburger and all of these various Texas Mexican and burgers.
David has never been to Texas before.
It's true.
It's
therefore,
hot here.
He's never had Whataburger.
So,
that's true.
Now, what have you had from Whataburger so far?
I've just had the burger. We tried to go there this morning for breakfast, but they didn't have breakfast, so
breakfast
we ended up getting tacos.
Breakfast is the best. Breakfast is the best. Yeah. If you get that
them
egg
taquitos.
Yeah, or the egg and cheese biscuits, man. Something about their biscuits is just, delicious.
Everybody when I was living about In-N-Out Burger, but
Who cares about that? When I was when I was living in Portland, I came back to Dallas for like Christmas or something, and I bought like six of those egg and cheese biscuits. I threw them in my suitcase, and I ate them over the next like month and a half.
Well done,
my gosh!
Yeah, they were
disgustingly
amazing.
Yeah.
So anyway.
So we're waiting for the Super Bowl and it's on.
Yeah, but who cares about
hours,
the Super Bowl? That's not the big
news.
Yeah,
none of us actually care about the Super Bowl at all.
That is not the big news of this week. This week was DFWC 4D.
DFWC 4D.
Mm-hmm.
Was a lot of fun. Turnout was amazing.
Turnout was excellent.
So I guess we'll just go in order, like kind of what we did. We started out with picking everybody up from the airport, obviously. We came in. What did we do that night? I don't even remember.
We went to dinner, I guess. We went to dinner and David got sick.
DJ played some Oculus. Oh, yeah.
Off of fajitas.
I ate way too much Mexican food and I had some beer. And the next morning I woke up with a migraine. And then, like, we were on the way to breakfast and we stopped to get EJ some coffee because apparently EJ needed to stop at two different coffee places before we went to lunch. And I was like, guys, I gotta puke. And I just like went back behind the bushes and like projectile vomited everywhere. It was a great morning. Just before we were meeting up with Bart and Damer and ABC.
Yeah.
It's a great first day in Texas.
Yeah, so EJ tried some stuff. We set up our gear. We got a lot of gear.
Mm-hmm.
An awful lot of gear.
We had a crazy amount of gear. We basically took all of our stuff into the Airbnb because we didn't have enough time to really check it at the place. And so Dave also bought some new equipment for us, which hopefully means that we will be able to, knock on wood, hopefully we will be able to start doing live stream video broadcasts.
It's good stuff, man.
Yeah.
It's really, really cool gear.
So, and we wanted to set that all up because, you know, it was new to us. And so we were testing that out and making sure we could get all of our video stuff. So I set up my Oculus Rift and let EJ play super hot while we were all just kind of BSing around, you know.
Super hot.
You guys put so much effort into DFWC 4D. I can't believe...
Oh my gosh, we've spent
got
so
a switcher.
Much money.
You had two projectors going and like we're live switching with dissolves. It's
wirelessly.
Way more gear than like, you know, the official C4D.
It is,
you know, Maxon or you know the SIGGRAPH and NAB stuff.
I don't know about that.
I don't know. Maybe not, but it's like it's up there with them. You guys are crazy, basically. You're crazy.
We're just trying to create a quality. We want, man. Yeah. See, the thing is, like, we just wanted people to come and have a good time, you know. And we wanted to we love Cinema 4D. We love the community, and we really want people to be passionate about it. And we want to see it grow. Mm-hmm. You know, who knows? Maybe one day this will grow to like South Res. You know, South by South, South Res.
South Res. South Res.
South West. By South Res. Yeah. Anyway,
that's third funny. Res.
Third Res.
I call this the third coast.
Or we could do low poly. We could call ourselves low poly. Yeah. No.
Nice.
No.
No. That fad's over.
But anyway.
EJ said that, yeah. EJ said that he wanted to do like quarter res or something.
Yeah, quarter res. See, but it, mm-hmm. yeah, I don't know. Maybe. Anyway.
You don't have to piggyback on the Grayscale Gorilla success.
We don't.
You can just make your own thing.
We don't, yeah. But anyway, I don't know. I think next time we should try and get the entire Grayscale crew down here and have them speak.
That would be
crazy. That would be ridiculously crazy. So
it's going to be hard to top this one.
It will be. Yeah.
That's what she said.
Oh, gosh.
And so, like, I mean, what if we could get, like, Beeple to come out?
Yeah.
Yeah, I would. That would be pretty crazy.
He's probably listening right now. Beeple, do you want to come to Texas and hang out?
Just hit
We've
us up on
great
our,
burgers.
On our group messaging thing that
we got
going on.
Tacos
there.
And burgers,
yeah.
And you can and Mexican, and you'll feel like butthole. Yeah. Great.
Well, it was so much fun. We got it all set up. We need to do a behind the scenes on the gear. Because mm-hmm. people couldn't even see how much gear we had back there. It was insane. We'll post pictures.
It was a really, like, the place that we had it at this time was so much better than the first place. Like, I enjoyed the first place because it was a good initial thing, and you know, mm-hmm. we had a good turnout. But man, this place was so much bigger, and it had that, you know, I was really worried about the little retaining wall or whatever, you know, the VIP area, quote unquote.
The VIP
but
area.
But we were able to hide all of our gear so well. You know,
yeah,
which was great,
and we had so many people that they had to start taking pool tables and covering them and putting chairs around them.
Yeah, which was pretty rad, you know. Yeah. And I was so nervous that we were gonna have too many people there because we gave away a bunch of tickets, but we only actually ended up having about 50% of the people. Of the people who got mm-hmm. tickets to actually show up. So and
that's
because
normal.
You're giving them away to for free. You know, I'm sure if you were charging for them, you know, that could be different. But.
Yeah, exactly. Whenever you give it free, they're like, oh, I'll get these tickets. And then mm-hmm. if I don't go, I don't go. And so even the woman that was in charge of our event mm-hmm. there was like, usually only 50-60% of people at a free event show up. So,
yeah,
you know, that was right dead on. But, man, it felt like more people, like the place was so packed.
Yeah. We had probably, you know? I mean, it's what, 70, 80 people just in a bar, you know?
Yeah.
And mm-hmm. I mean, it's a bar with pool tables and places to hang out and stuff, but man, it was a lot of fun. It was a
pretty much
stuff.
Everybody had seating, which was really cool.
Yeah.
It actually did feel, you know, it wasn't like everybody had to stand.
Yeah.
Also, I can't believe that everybody got to, you know, some kind of free thing, whether it was a free drink or
everyone basically mm-hmm. everyone who stuck around till the end either got like a free drink or a free t-shirt or, you know, one of the cool plugins that we gave away or mm-hmm. something like that. So I was really happy about that. I was really. And then stupid me is like, okay, all you guys will have a chance to win everything and throw all the tickets in. Then I'm like, oh no, now I gotta start over.
Oh, no,
so I had to rehand out tickets to every single person.
Yeah.
So but yeah, it was
so
a lot of fun.
It was fun. We went late, pretty late. And for me, like, I didn't want to have a drink until, like, right before.
Uh-huh.
Because I was super nervous about my deal. So I was like, I want one drink to calm my nerves.
You're so funny.
But, well, the thing is that I wrote my entire thing that morning.
I know.
And I had not
rehearsed. Yeah, that would make me real nervous.
And so...
You guys are so funny.
I'm not nervous
you
in front
guys
of
are
anybody.
So
I just make
funny.
Jokes on the fly. My name's Matt Milstead. Blah, 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 blah.
It's true. Like, I went over my thing, like, once in the morning mm-hmm. before, and I really wasn't doing anything. I just wanted to make sure that I knew what I was doing. I mean, my presentation was nowhere as good as y'all's. Like,
whatever.
Nowhere as good. But
Octane kept
basically,
crashing on you, and you handled it like a pro.
Oh, whatever.
You were just like, no big deal, whatever.
Well, and I made sure to, you know, preface it at the beginning that we were all gonna watch real flow crash my computer.
Crash. It was so, true. It came true.
Yeah. So anyway, exactly. I don't know. It was fun. Anyway.
EJ got that one Facebook comment.
That was funny.
That was interesting. And I think she's a friend of our friends or something, but basically, like, in a nutshell, where is the thing? Gosh, we've been having this huge group chat. She said it was interesting. It totally focused on C4D, and there wasn't much of After Effects or Adobe products.
Right.
And at the same, and then the same feelings of Apple letting down the art community and leaving the sinking ship for PCs. And, mm-hmm. you know, it's like, she said she felt a little disheartened. You know, she's like, are we going down the wrong road with AE? Should we abandon ship and start learning Cinema 4D? And obviously, those are two completely different programs.
Yeah, it all depends on what, like, when it came to After Effects with me, I absolutely loved After Effects. I still love After Effects. I think it is an awesome, amazing tool. But I wanted to start doing more 3D text and 3D, you know, actual 3D space and stuff. That's why I picked up Cinema.
EJ referred to having to go over to After Effects as a truck stop bathroom.
Yeah.
Get in, get out.
Get in, get out.
It's my favorite thing. That was my favorite part of his presentation.
Mm-hmm. But, and also, like, what he was talking about wasn't comping in particular. He was talking about, like, if you're trying to make cartoon stuff in After Effects, it's really better just to move over to Cinema. But, like, they're two completely different things. So
they are.
You know, the other thing is, we didn't want to step on Trent's After Effects meetups because they have a really large crowd. And, like, we would just be doing the same thing that he is. And we don't want to be doing the same exact thing.
Yeah.
They had a meeting the week before.
Yeah, and you were there. I was actually considering, like, basically straight up ripping off his presentation at the After Effects user group and just kind of showing off After Effects' new Cinema 4D renderer and stuff like that. But then I was like, you know what? This is, it's fine. It's no big deal. You know, it's DFW C4D. You know, it's a chance for all of us to come out and celebrate Cinema 4D. For those who don't know Cinema 4D, it's a chance to get to learn Cinema 4D and see what it has to offer, you know?
Totally.
And so...
I feel like, this is just a random aside, but I feel like most artists I know began with After Effects and then, integrated C4D, and they obviously play extremely well together. It's very useful to know both. But there are some artists now that I'm seeing that actually start purely with C4D because the daily rendering scene took off so hard. Like, for instance, Frederic Duquette, who's one of my new friends from Canada. He's the FVCK render, which I can't say on this show, but he started with C4D and he's like, man, I got to learn After Effects. I really got to learn After Effects. And I feel like even like maybe Beeple kind of started more with the C4D stuff, I think, and Illustrator for sure. But I'm not sure like how much he uses After Effects. I don't know. It's a good question.
I don't know.
I only just learned Photoshop layers yesterday.
No, it's masks. I just learned
masks. How to do a mask.
Right. Yeah.
Z depth pass. What's that? I don't know. Anyway, interesting. You know, you can come at it from multiple routes or whatever.
Hey, I don't know about you guys, but I'm still trying to recover from DFW C4D.
Feel pretty crappy right now. My brain's not working.
I have been just exhausted.
Like, well, also, we had that tech scout the next day.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Oh, my gosh. That was grueling. Like, 15 minutes of work and then standing around for, like, an hour and a half. Oh, my gosh. My feet were killing me. I went to bed at, like, 8:30 that night.
Yeah, that's nice. It's because like we were standing the whole day before setting up for the show, and the whole night, like 12 hours on our feet, and then the next day we woke up super early.
Yep,
and went out and stood all day again.
Yeah, it was awful.
I oh my gosh, I hurt so bad. I was so like, I'm just like y'all. My head is cloudy. Mm-hmm. I can't think straight. I'm just, that's why today is David and I were talking about this earlier. This is just chill and do like nothing day.
We're gonna watch some Rick and Morty, play some Halo.
Yeah,
we already did some droning.
That's fun.
It was fun.
All right, so the tech scout we were going to talk about a little bit, because we're not really going to talk about like what it is or what the client is right now, but we did kind of want to talk about like what is involved in doing a tech scout for VFX. Because some people are new to it, and you know, you got to know what questions to ask and what to look for, especially if you're going to do 3D tracks.
Mm-hmm.
So for example, like we went into one location and it had a lot of blank walls, like super, super blank walls. And so what do you do in that case? You know, are you going to have a hard time tracking that? Are there going to be issues with painting things out? So, you know, it's really good to have these tech scouts because you can test it out. And in this case, even they're recording some footage. It's not on the nice camera that we're going to be using, which is like an Alexa, but it's still on like an SLR. So we're going to be able to get a little simple, like rough pretend edit and take that footage in and do some tracking and just see what it does, even without tracking markers, which is really nice to have. So what else do we have besides that store? We had a factory.
We had the shiny floor place.
The shiny floor place. So the shiny floor place, you know, we're talking about adding stuff in. So we're talking about doing this little fake archway. And it's like, okay, well, how does that affect the reflections in this floor? Because they're so bright and they're very squiggly. You know, so we're like, okay, we could do like other reflections on this and add a purlin noise, but then it's a moving camera shot. So you're also dealing with like moving squiggly reflections and bump. And it's like, that's the stuff you have to look for. There were other things too. Like there's a lot of stuff we're going to paint out, and some of it in some instances was like
overhanging.
Yeah, it was overhanging. So like you can't paint out parallax stuff that easy.
Yeah, it's really hard.
And so that's one thing to look out for. What was the other thing? Like, oh, in the factory, the cables.
Oh, those cables. Well, they didn't want to get rid of those, so that's good.
No, but see, but that's what you have to look out for, because we were looking, we're like, do you want us to paint those out? Because that's going to be really difficult.
Yeah, totally. I'm glad they said, no, we don't need you to.
Yeah. There's stuff like artwork, you know, that we're like, do we can we paint that out or not? And
yeah, whether or not they can take it off the walls, etc.
And then some of it, we're adding some 3D, a lot of 3D into the scene. So we're going to do HDR 360 photos
with that Ricoh Theta.
And those are the kind of things you got to look out for. And even in workflow, we were talking about how we're going to deliver. So what is it? We're doing, okay, so we're getting,
I think we're doing three layers, right? We're doing, and then just handing that straight over to the colorist.
We're getting log footage in from the Alexa. And because this spot's going to be half of it's black and white and half of it, so like the background is black and white and the people are in color. So we're basically going to hand the colorist just log footage that's been treated with our CG and with removals and all that, which will look identical to what we're getting in. But we're also going to hand him a black and white mat that's just DPX of whatever roto we do, so that he can then adjust everything to taste. So he can do one grade on the people and another grade on the background. But I think it's just two layers.
Yeah, it's two layers and a mask, right?
I don't even think we need to do that. I think we just need one layer that's log with color and the mask. And so he can do the black and white on his end.
Yeah.
And then, yeah.
David, we need to get you to do some Resolve tutorials.
Yeah, man. I'll
do it. That would be cool. Because, you know,
I love me some Resolve.
Basically, I want people to do tutorials for us that I want to learn about. So
just like all the things, I can just be your personal tutor and you just ask me the things and then I'll do the tutorials. All right. Totally. I'm down.
Well, like today we took a little bit of log footage on the drone and I threaded the needle. We went out to this construction site and I flew the drone. They, for the weekend, you know, they always kind of put their machinery into some sort of mode where it's hard to steal it, I guess. So
yeah,
there's like a dump truck and they took the it's not a steam shovel. What do you call it?
Steam shovel.
That's what it used to be called, like back in the day. But the it's not a bulldozer. It has the dig thing on it. I don't know what it is. It's
the excavator.
Excavator.
Yeah.
Is that what it is?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think so.
It was landed inside of the back of the dump truck. So
yeah,
it excavator. Was making like an arch. So I took the drone and I did this fly through and like threaded the needle through.
Were you doing it super quick?
No,
you're too nervous. Well, too nervous. If I were really close, I would have threading the needle though. If you're You're just like, oh, well, I'm still slowly going through it.
The only
whatever,
reason
man,
it was
slow, extreme. It was extreme.
We were really far away from it. We weren't like next. If we were next to it, I could have done it by eye. Mm-hmm. But we were so far away, like you couldn't tell from far away. It looked like you were going to hit it from far away. Mm-hmm. The angle. Yeah. And so I went through. But I would love to take that footage. I think we'll throw it into Resolve. And like Dave's going to show me how to color correct it and make it cool. Look cool.
I feel that's like I want to move my entire editing over to Resolve. You know, I mean, they've got the free version.
And no, you don't. No, you don't want to do any editing in Resolve. No.
Okay, well, never mind then.
Do your editing in Premiere. Yeah. Resolve is for color. Resolve tries to be like, oh, we're an editor. We're an NLE, blah, blah, blah. Premiere is way better.
Okay. I feel the same way. I tried
well,
to
then,
do some stuff.
Just, well, then.
Delete Resolve.
Who am I? Wrong.
I have no idea. Wrong,
I was trying to be. I'm terrible Trump impression. Just like during the debates, he was like, "Wrong, wrong,
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 wrong."
Anyway, the Melissa McCarthy of impression of Sean Spicer was freaking Spicer. Hilarious.
I haven't watched the whole video yet. But
oh
I really
my gosh,
to, yeah.
She is so good.
Yeah.
So we have like a ton of questions from people, and it's so awesome. And that's mainly what we're going to focus on today. Because we're not going to do a super long show because we're just going to chill and recover and maybe watch some cool Super Bowl commercials when the sports ball show comes on TV. I barely know who's playing. But the first one, I think that, okay, so this is the one that we got last week that we said we were going to wait on because we really didn't want to rush through these questions last week and we were already kind of over time. So, the first one is from Leo Bonarigo. Bonarigo, does that look
sounds
right?
Looks right to me, Leo. Okay. Bonarigo. Yeah.
And it says, "What up, bros? Love the show. And since you've been requesting questions / discussion topics recently, I figured I'd send along a few ideas. And I just finally wrote a review on iTunes too, which I think we wrote.
Yeah,
that
we
last
did. We did read that last week.
Cool. He says, I've got a bunch of questions around client relations and client management, mainly how you guys communicate with clients who have no idea what goes into your work. Not sure how often you deal with these issues, but I'm constantly fighting the battle of dealing with people who don't understand amount of time and effort that goes into any motion graphics project, After Effects or C4D, and needing to educate them or deal with them after wrongly assuming they understand that things take time and effort. So a few questions, any of which would be great if you could get to. So number one, at early stages, how do you communicate / justify, though I hate that word,
justify,
why projects
yeah.
cost what they do and or take as long as they do to clients?
That's a really long, I mean, that's okay. Repeat that one more time because you asked a couple different questions in there.
Well, we'll kind of address the main question in these questions. So mm-hmm. in the early stages, when we start talking about doing a project and uh-huh. what it's going to cost, first of all, when we get somebody who comes to us and says, hey, can you do this? And how long is it going to take?
Mm-hmm.
Rarely do we have people like get upset when we say it's going to take a certain amount of time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that anybody who, to be straight honest with you, anybody who doesn't want to pay you a certain amount of money to do something or mm-hmm. thinks it's ridiculous how long it will take, you don't want them as a client in the first
place.
Yeah,
you really don't.
Totally.
Because they're
it's a filter.
If you spend a bunch of time doing something for someone and don't charge them enough, you're not selling yourself
you're not
for what
yourself.
You're worth, you know? Right. And really, if by doing cheap work, doing good and cheap work, you know, like you really degrade the value of our entire industry, you know, to that person at
and
least.
And of course, you're going to get those people who come back and say, well, what if you're brand new? And what if if you want to do something for exposure, blah, blah, blah. I like what Nick said years ago, which I think he got from somebody else, which is work for full price or work for free.
Mm-hmm. I like that.
Yep.
And I admit we do have a couple clients that we give them a little bit of a discount, but it's mm-hmm. still not like, it's not cheap.
It's only because We only give them a discount because they have been clients since for like 11 years. You know?
Or because it's kind of bulk too. They give us a lot of work.
Yeah, it's kind of like the whole Domino's pizza thing, right? You buy three pizzas for $15. Yeah, it's really cheap and you don't make a lot of money off of it, but because so many people are ordering three pizzas for $15, you get so many massive orders that your profit margins just skyrocket. I use that example because I worked at Domino's Pizza during the three for $15 and it was our busiest month ever.
It's still like that now, isn't it? It's very
close. I think it's $3 for $5.55 each. They brought it up a 50 cents dollar.
But, you know, dealing with the people who don't understand the time and effort, like, you've got to let them understand. You've got to make them understand somehow. And how do you do that? If, you know, like I said, if a client just will not get that and will not understand that, you don't want them. But maybe you can help them understand.
Yeah.
And so what would be a good way to help them understand that it's extremely difficult, especially C4D stuff?
What's a way to help them understand? I don't know. Kind of like, okay, so what we kind of base everything on, what we've always done, is we base on how many days. We charge a day rate, you know? And if we've got multiple people working on it, we charge multiple days, you know? So say it's 2 days, but it's only going to take 1 day for both of us working together on it. That's still 2 days, right?
Right.
So we try to figure out how many days total it will take to get a project done, you know? And the problem is, like, if you haven't done it enough, you don't know how many days it's going to take, you know? If it's something new to you, you could underquote yourself or overquote yourself or something like that. But we've been doing it enough to know, well, okay, so we've got to create this logo, we've got to do this animation, we've got to do three more things on top of that. That's going to take 2.5 days or something like that. You know, we know about how long it takes for each of us to do that. Am I answering this question at all? Like, I mean, no, really, that... like, it's you learn about how long it's going to take through experience and through doing it over and over again. You know,
yeah, but what about the client not knowing?
Well, then you just explain to them what goes into each day. Right.
So you can also do like a breakdown sheet, you know, and list out this cost for this task and that kind of, and that kind of stuff.
Like, for example, okay, we've got a logo design that's going to take half a day. All right. And that's normally, so what we've got to do is that we've got to take in your Illustrator file. If you don't have an Illustrator file, that may take a couple, you know, extra hours to have to retrace and redo your entire stuff, get it into Illustrator, extrude it, light it, you know, make the fly-ins, do the, spline deformers or whatever it is, the what is that called?
Yeah, no, I agree with that. Like, some sort of a breakdown is definitely the way to go,
and especially for people who are brand new at this. You know, like the clients who are brand new at this, they don't really understand. You know, so the more you can educate them, actually, the more you can educate them, the better it is, not only for you but also for our industry as a whole, because they understand it's so much easier to work with a client who understands what has to go into it than just a blind client who's just like, well, this so-and-so from this college charged me $50 to do this, you know?
Right, yeah. But they're a college student.
And if a client says that to you, then you say, all right, go work with that guy.
And you get what you pay for. And, and I really, I mean, I've straight up said that to people before. I said, honestly, I'll be perfectly honest with you. You get what you pay for. And if you can get it for $100 from a college student, that's fine. But when they have trouble getting it to you because they're in the middle of doing classes or they just completely don't deliver at all, then you're out $100 and you have no product.
Yeah, and especially if that client is just the middleman for a much bigger client, which is what tends to happen a lot.
Yeah,
is you've got these producers or something like that who bring in a bunch of work and then outsource it to, you know, all of us.
And we're not stupid. We know it's getting marked up.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
And they're trying to, they take their 30% profit margins.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I don't know.
The thing too is, a lot of times if you break it down for people to that detailed level, you know, like all the stuff you're going to do, sometimes they actually get mad about it. And they're like, "Oh, I don't understand all of this. You know, you're making it sound super complicated. Like, you know, it's like, I think only if somebody asks you for that should you break it down. I don't think like a regular client, I would say, okay, I'm going to do this and I have to do these deformers and then do this kind of projection.
Right, but you could do a simpler, like some of my projects, like will have editing and color grading and VFX.
Totally.
And I'll be like, I want to, you know, allocate this many hours to editing and this many hours to color. And I think from experience that these kinds of shots take this long and it's all based on my hourly rate of this, you know?
Right. Yeah. The one we're working on right now, we were talking about doing that mask, and those masks are going to be coming in from a whole bunch of rota work. And I even told him up front, I'm like, look, the rota work is the hardest part of this whole thing. You know, we're going to 3D track pretty easy and start working on things, but that's kind of like, once we get those tracks and once we just start building 3D stuff, that's what we usually do.
Yeah.
That's no biggie. But, but man, like, it's going to be some really, really grueling roto, and there could be hair follicles that need to be fixed and tracked and this whole thing. And it's just, it's not even that it's hard, it's just really time consuming.
Yeah, exactly.
And so,
and there's still,
that's all broken down.
There are some okay tools for roto work. Like the roto brush is okay if you've got I will speak highly about the roto brush because I've used for a few projects. I mean, I don't know if it's good enough for commercial grade. Yeah, for production stuff. But I mean, you know, cutting out a dude and sticking him in a crappy scene and stuff. Yeah, that's all right. You know, sticking him in the background. Right.
But like, as far as
it's probably going to be done really good for roto.
The
work.
Roto brush is good for trees. You can get, because it's got the refine edge tool as well. You can like get a soft, it'll do a combination of a Luma key and that kind of vector thing. So it'll get those really soft edges that if you tried to cut out by hand, it would take a million years, and you can just do it really quickly. So yeah, roto brush is good for some things, but I definitely don't think it's that great for straight up roto of people. I don't know.
So the other part of this is if a client comes with a preconceived notion of what your work costs and it's ridiculously low, how do you respond?
Bye.
So I guess the thing, but like of what your personal work costs, I guess that's the question. Don't allow yourself to come across as cheap from the get-go. And if you do, like, you might want to just kind of get past those clients and reestablish yourself.
Totally.
They should respect the fact that the cost of living goes up, that your quote unquote popularity may go up, and that your schedule may get incredibly busy, and you just, that's all it is. You know, we talked with that episode with EJ a while back about how sometimes you got to raise your rates, and usually the clients are okay with that.
Yeah. We raised our rates at the beginning of January, and we haven't had anyone complain about it. Haven't lost, I don't think, even a single client, except for maybe the one that we wanted to lose.
Right.
So that was the whole point. That was the whole point of us raising our rates.
Right. And let's see, any tips on a concise way to explain to the layman what rendering is and why it takes time, mainly for 3D? Agency folks are so used to instant gratification and now that I need a good way to say, hey, this isn't instantaneous.
I don't know. I feel like most people should know what rendering is. Like, yeah. I mean, I don't know, like, you just explain it, you know, but you got to explain it in a pretty, in layman's terms, you're right. So like, basically,
computer processing is the way that I explain it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I say basically you're building it into the computer and you've got all these different layers and blah, 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 blah. And you're building something that you can watch. But in order to get it out of your actual system, it takes time in order to go through and make your final version. You know, it's just like saving out any other file. It's just this save of a file takes much, much longer.
So there are these magical digital buckets, and they all come together to make a render. Then you have one render, and then you have to get 24 renders per second.
Unless you're running.
That's a lot of buckets.
Yeah. That's a lot of buckets.
Bucket per minute. times 60 buckets per render times 24. I don't know.
You sound like the DNA guy from...
I think I was trying to do... from Jurassic Park. What is that?
Dinosaurs.
Dinosaurs?
I think I was doing that. I think I was doing the derpy derp, a turtle term to do.
Oh, yeah.
Voice, yeah.
Stapler.
The Stapler.
Yeah. Rob Schneider. Schneider. Anyway. Yeah, I don't know how you explain rendering. Just say the computer takes a long time to process to create a single picture. I don't know. You don't have to get more specific than that.
And
yeah.
A lot of times it kind of like is it makes a difference if you are the type of person who charges for rendering or not.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know,
if you don't charge for it, you can almost slide that in there. Let them know that they're not getting charged for rendering because it makes you look better by saying, oh, yeah, this is going to take 12 hours, but don't worry, I don't charge for rendering.
But technically, you're building that into your daily rate.
Yeah, you really should. Yeah.
But the thing about it is, if you are doing your stages of production right, then that shouldn't be a big deal because if you say, okay, you're going to get 3 revision rounds, then you're going to do 1 render and then you're going to come back to them and say, okay, well, what do you want in phase 2? You know, they're not going to come back to the first render and say, hey, change this thing. And then the first round is done. No, after you render, that's already stage 1. It's done. It's gone. You're in stage 2 now. And just make sure that they know that that's how it works. Just be really clear with that from the get-go, especially if you're doing a contract. That, like, we need approval from not just you, but all the decision makers, everybody involved, all at once in one thing. Mm-hmm. Not like, here's my ideas, and then tomorrow someone else sends another email and says, oh, but you know what would be really cool? But you've already rendered it.
Yeah.
Because that's where you get into trouble.
Yeah. I actually have this one client where, you know, they complained about the cost of what it initially... you know, what it was going to cost, the quote that I gave them. And I said, well, if you're prepared, unlike the last time, if it's like last time, then yes, it's going to cost that much. But we've done a few of these so where you know what it takes. So I would assume that we will be more prepared for this, you know?
Right.
Nope. It ended up being exactly like it was the time before, and they ended up paying the same amount, you know? And so one of the rounds of approvals, they said, they're like, well, let's go ahead and change this and this and this. And I'm like, well, is that just you saying it, or is that everyone else? Because I know you were trying to save money, you know? So do you want me to go ahead and do this, or do you want to get everyone else's approval? I'll just go ahead and do it. And they ended up, once he sent it to the client, they ended up changing just about everything that he had told us to do.
Back to how you had it in the first place, actually. I believe. And so it's kind of like, you shouldn't be upset if you're not saving money because you are not prepared.
Right.
Lack of preparation on your part doesn't constitute an emergency on mine.
Right.
So you got to tell them. It's up to you. However prepared you are is how much money you're going to save. It's really that simple. And so put it in their hands. You know, if you guys give me all this stuff at once, then we can knock this out in these steps, and we're totally going to get this done in an efficient amount of time. We're going to save you money, and that's really all it takes. And then when they come back with those changes, say, hey, this contract said there's a change order, has a change order clause, and says that we have to kind of rework these numbers if this happens. So I'm going to send over a new contract. This is how long I think it's going to take now because you changed the scope of the project.
Yep.
What, if any, language do you include in estimates, SOWs, to prevent scope creep? That's kind of like what we just talked about. So say you sell a low poly stylized animation and a client comes back and says, this doesn't look realistic enough, which to us is insane. So if you sold a low poly idea, I mean, they've seen examples of what low poly looks like.
Yeah, absolutely. And then you just have to explain to them, hey, listen, I think we've run into that before where they're like, oh, well, this doesn't look, you know, we're expecting this. And you're like, well, these are the examples. And that's why it's really good to have, you know, a fair amount of examples and really get down to the nitty gritty of which sample they would really like to emulate, so to say.
Right. And then when you provide things like super, super, super early feedback, like wireframes, things like that. Or even if, let's say you're going to do something that's really complicated, start showing them some, maybe a still before you really get into it. And say, this is a still of where we're going. You know, just kind of prevent that by showing them different stages of the process, at least still frames.
Yeah.
If you're using Octane, you can do really grainy renders that spit out quickly. And that communicates like 95% of the design, lighting, animation. Like that is very close to the final look, but you don't have to sit there forever waiting for the renders to come in.
Yeah,
that's what Barton said in his talk at the last DFWC4D. If you go back and watch that, they do these like super small, you know, maybe like 300 by something, 10 sample renders or whatever it is. And they show it to him and say, look, we're not talking about how realistic it looks or the grain or anything. We're talking about the animation. We're talking about the lighting. We're talking about all of that. So you just squint your eyes and pretend that it looks good. You know? He says, anyway, I'll probably be back with more, but curious to get some insight on how you deal with educating clients. Thanks for your work on the podcast and makes my dog walks much more enjoyable.
Nice. That's where I'm at. Yeah.
All right. Let's move on to Vlad.
Vlad. Hello, Vlad.
I don't even want to attempt that last name. You guys want to give it a go?
Yeah.
Bahatrievich. I feel like this guy has asked questions before.
I think he
nailed it.
Yeah, I really think you did. You've been practicing it for the past 45 minutes, haven't you?
I actually just looked at it and I don't think that's right either. Bahatrievich. I don't know.
Trevik.
Let's just call him Vlad.
Call
him Vlad. All right. Question for the show. Hey, guys. It's always a pleasure listening to the podcast. Keep it up. I have a couple of BroGraph questions/topic suggestions, which could be interesting to cover in the future. Number one, how do you stay motivated by making the work of a similar nature? How do you stay motivated by making the work of a similar nature? I'm not sure I quite understand
Say you're doing the exact same type of stuff, you know, like logo work. How do we make logo work fun? You know, because we do a buttload of logo work. So how do you keep it interesting? And the one thing that I have found, at least with this logo work that we've been doing, you know, how to keep it less boring is, you know, when I go through and I'll watch tutorials or I'll hear new things or something, maybe I just want to try something new. You know, if it doesn't work out, it doesn't work out. That's fine. But you know what? Let's just try something new. Let's try and get crazy. You know, just try and make the best work you can and try something
whatever.
New. Like logos are great to be able to try something. Exactly. New, you know?
Yeah. Whatever you're doing, you could probably be getting better at that, even if it seems repetitive. There are new things that you could be doing, new techniques that you could be implementing, and, you know, just try to do research and make it fresh for yourself. Yeah. And if you've reached a plateau, then try to start doing passion projects and branching yourself out to new types of work, basically.
Yeah,
but you know what?
I get real bored doing the same thing.
It pays the bills, you know?
That's true. My editing jobs are very repetitive, but they are the highest paying, I think.
I spent a good, like, 6 months one time doing roto work, you know? And, like, it was... Yeah, it was awful. It was totally awful.
But I bet you listened to lots of podcasts.
Yeah. Lots of podcasts, lots of books. That's where I was introduced to Gary Vee, you know? And it's like...
Yeah.
Gary V.
Sometimes the work sucks. Sometimes it does, and you just gotta, you know, begrudgingly get through it. So try something outside.
Sometimes I like the repetitive work, especially if I've done like a bunch of challenging things in a row, and I just want to zone out. And I'm like, this is something that I know I can do. It's stupid and easy, and I'm just gonna do it, and then I'm gonna make money. You know.
Yeah.
And that can be nice, too. But if you get a bunch of those in a row, it can be draining because you're just not learning anything. You feel like you're plateauing, and you hate yourself.
That's funny.
The other question is, do you counter any of your clients' feedback, or do you find it easier to just do it their way?
Sometimes.
That happens a lot.
Yeah.
And, you know, a lot of times I don't like the feedback, but I don't feel that there's a good reason to counter it.
Right.
And I just do it because it's like, that's what they want. Okay, we'll do it and we'll listen.
I try.
Sometimes, like,
And this happens often. Well, not often. This happens sometimes where I'll try and counter the feedback with, you know, either BS excuses or, you know, reasons why I felt it should be like that. You know, because let's be honest, sometimes it is just a BS excuse, you know, like just because you don't want to do the work. But like, right. I'm serious. So like, but sometimes, and I'll be the first one to admit this, sometimes their changes actually make the product look better.
Oh, yeah.
You know?
Oh, yeah.
And so like, you know, there have been a few times where I'm like, oh, I don't want to do that because I think it'll look awful. And then I end up doing it and I'm like, okay.
Yeah.
They were right. That was actually pretty good.
It's just like with you giving me the feedback on the BroGraph logo I'm working on. It's like,
I know you hated it.
I purposely put a whole bunch of colors because it was supposed to be kind of goofy and like fantabulous. Uh-huh. And, but there were, once you kind of brought it up, I started thinking about it. I'm like, yeah, I could tone back the color variety just a little bit.
Yeah.
You know, and I think it would be for the better.
Yeah. I mean, it's all about creating. It's all about creating a quality product, really, you know? But sometimes you just get those crappy clients who are like, nah, let's throw 10 lens flares in there, you know? Mm-hmm. It'll look great. And you're like, well, I think, you know, maybe one lens flare, maybe two will look good. But like, you know, it's like, nah, you know what? Let's go even more. Let's get 20 lens flares. And sometimes you just do it. Because at the end of the day, you know, it's great because you start every project thinking that you're going to put it on your reel. You're like, yeah, I'm going to put this one on my reel. And then they throw that stuff at you and you're like, well, this one's not going on
my reel. Well, that's why you put an earlier version on your reel, which is exactly what I did with Zika when they made the stupid decision about the black mosquitoes. I've got up on Vimeo, I don't have those mosquitoes in it. I've got the older version. I put in my director's cut or whatever, you know.
Yeah.
Ours are probably the new ones. They're just black.
So, on my first pass, before the client sees it, I try to make it as good as possible to my own eye.
Yeah.
And then if the client says something they want changed that I think could be really stupid, I try to skew that in a way that addresses their feedback but keeps it looking good. So I think my job is to make it look the best that it possibly can, you know? And, that's just kind of...
With the Zika thing... It was like we had a good color palette for them.
We did.
Right.
And they said, well, Zika mosquitoes don't look like that.
Yeah.
And it's like, do you think anybody watching this commercial is going to say, that's not the color of a Zika mosquito?
Yeah.
Nobody knows. Yeah. I had to Google
some cartoony stuff.
Yeah. All the biologists are like, what? What are they doing?
Oh, blasphemy.
No, the mosquitoes
aren't blue. Realistic at all.
Yeah. They're black and white.
We brought it up and they were really insistent on it. And we're like, well, it kind of like, tones down the whole look, but we'll do it.
Yeah. So at that point, I'm like, all right, let's take a snapshot of the project at this moment that it looks really good. And that's what I'm going to use for my reel. That's what I'm going to upload to my personal Vimeo. And then for them, they can have their version. Mm-hmm. That's why there are so many directors with commercials that will do a director's cut that they like because they've got all the footage. You know, they want the director's cut. So I'll do the director's cut for them. And then I'll do the cut for the agency as well.
Yeah.
And that's the one that actually gets used. But the directors get to promote the work that they like on their site.
I did some work for the Big 12 conference down here in Texas one time, and they had this director on set who was directing everything, you know, and like when he
like you do
he finished the thing, and once the edit was all done, instead of putting that on his reel, he re-edited the entire thing and made it a Nike commercial and put that on his website.
Oh, that's a little weird.
Yeah, terrible. Yeah, yeah. I thought that was pretty ridiculous.
Like one of our clients last week, we had recorded audio on site.
Mm-hmm.
And in the first rough draft round, we just threw the raw audio on there. And we had, you know, super, super raw voiceover audio. But then we had like a completely sweetened and compressed track from premiumbeat.com, you know, so premium the background track com. It's so incredibly compressed that it's pegging zero the whole time, right? And so his track was like super low, and so I had to kind of bring that other track down, and so we send that, and then we had a second round where we actually had gone through. I brought the entire track into Logic and I mixed it and I did stereo spreading and normalization and compressing and gating and limiting, and EQing and the whole deal, and then I perfectly merged it with the background audio track and did sweetening for hours. Mm-hmm. And then we get back the feedback, well, we liked the audio in the first one better because it was softer. And I was trying to explain to them that there is no such thing as softer volume. Mm-hmm. Like, as far as, I mean, that's a relative thing, right? So they said, make it as soft as it was before. I'm like, just turn your volume down on your speakers. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, there's no deal for that. Like I didn't know how to explain that.
So you basically gave it more separation so that the perceived loudness was greater. Is that what you're saying?
Well, it wasn't even that. It was just that it like the other track aside, it was compressed, so it was pegging zero like it should be. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know, when you're mixing something that's going to go on television, it needs to be the same level as everything else on TV. Mm-hmm. You know, have you ever been watching TV and all of a sudden a commercial comes on?
Yeah, there are laws for that. When I deliver spots, there's like a negative 24 LKFS, which stands for, it's the loudness value. And so there's a little filter in Premiere where you can actually measure the loudness or whatever, and it's got to be below negative 24 or below.
Yeah.
That's good to know. Yeah. I didn't know about that.
Yeah.
And the original, because we were using the microphones that, I forget which microphone we were using, but, you know, we like to keep our audio a little bit low so that there's no chance of pegging because it's digital. There's not much noise in it. We'll have plenty of headroom to bring it up. The worst thing is overmodulating. You can't bring it down, you know? So better to have a little headroom than to have overmodulation. Mm-hmm. So that's just where it was at the get-go on that first round. And I'm just trying to explain. No, you don't understand. Yeah, but we want it to be soft because we want it to just be laid back and like totally chill. I'm like, right, but you don't understand. Anybody who plays that might have their speakers low. They might have them high. Let's say we give it to them and it's super low, right? Like at negative 40 dB or something. Mm-hmm. And then they turn up their speakers because they're like, I can't hear what they're saying. And they jack up their speakers all the way. Mm-hmm. All of a sudden, there's all this noise or hum from their own personal speakers.
Yep.
And it just sounds awful. And let's say, for example, they're looking at competitors. They're looking at other people in the industry. They look at one reel. They look at another reel. They look at another reel for these guys. And then they come across our client's reel. And they hit play. And it's, you can't hear it in comparison.
Yeah.
Because everybody else did their audio the right way. I said, then yours is going to come along and nobody's going to be able to hear it. And they'll be like, even subconsciously, they'll be like, in the back of their head, they're like, the production value on this is sucky compared to the others because I can't hear it now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And even if they don't know anything about audio, it's a subconscious trigger that they're just going to be like, They're going to be like, something's wrong. Something's wrong here. What's the deal? And I said, I think what you guys are really looking at is like, how loud is the music compared to the vocals? Mm-hmm. You know, so let's try adjusting that and see, because you can take your television and you could turn it down, you know, 5 to 10 pegs, and it's going to sound exactly like it did before. Anyway.
I just got a text message from my cousin that said, I was watching this Disneyland video and you and your kid are in it. I'm like, what? It's got like 60,000 views. It's some guy who reviews Disneyland and I'm apparently in there trying to pull the sword from the stone with Gibson.
No way. No way.
Isn't that ridiculous?
That's crazy.
Yeah, see? That's me. Up on YouTube.
What?
Isn't that crazy?
That's random.
Gosh, I had really shag. Oh, I forgot. That was when I was growing out my beard. What a mistake that was.
Yeah. All right. Where are we at on these questions here?
How do you find new clients?
Ooh, how do you find new clients?
How do clients react when they know you work from home?
That's a really good question. That's a really good question. Okay, so here's what I'll say as far as the finding new clients. I have no clue. They just seem to come and find us.
They magically appear.
Here's what I will say. Do quality work and the clients will come to you. If you're lazy, if you just want to get stuff out the door and just make a paycheck, then you're not going to start gaining a good clientele base. If you do good quality work
then you will just gain clients through word of mouth, through people talking and such. I worked at a place one time. It's not the best place, you know, but they were one of the only places in town that did what they did, and they did an okay job at it. And they never advertised. And for 20 something years, they just kept on growing and growing and growing, eventually until everyone could do it at their house. And then they started shrinking and shrinking. So,
yeah,
I don't know.
Yeah. Like, most of my clients have been word of mouth for sure.
Yeah.
Or I mean, just, you know, networking is huge, obviously. Mm-hmm. I don't, that's what I was you know, everybody say. Always says that, but definitely go to meetups and they're fun. It's fun to meet other people and geek out talking about stuff that you guys do. It's a shared interest and, you know.
I mean, you can network with people for years and then it may take like 5 years before somebody comes back and says, oh, hey, wait, like I know these guys that do this thing. Mm-hmm. Let's talk to them. Mm-hmm. You never know.
I've gotten lots of clients just doing film shoots, like being a DIT on set. People will come and stare over my shoulder and they're like, what are you doing? I'm like, I'm making this color. And by the way, hey, check out my reel. And they're like, whoa, dude, I'll pass this to blah, blah, blah. And, you know, or it'll be the director. And you meet, you know, big production people that way. And it's, you know, DPs, like our line of work can be really useful for DPs if you're doing VFX. And then everybody's always got some project that they want. You know, everybody's got projects. It's just, it's crazy.
Our biggest job we got last year came from us because Dave and I went on a live event project. That was the biggest job that we did last year. And it was the big, you know, church Christmas spot, you know. Like, that was our biggest one last year, and it all happened because we went and ran graphics for a live event. You know? You never know who you're going to network with.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm really bad about this, but always keep your business card on you. Keep a business card on you.
Put a bunch in your wallet.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then, you know, and like I was...
And your demo reel on your phone, too.
Yeah, so keep your demo reel on your phone. Or at least some really good examples and stuff like that that you can kind of talk about. You know, DFW C4D, we spent a lot of money on it. We spent a buttload of money on it. And it was free for everyone who came. But it was really networking for us. That was kind of a way for us to be able to network and talk to people. We had one guy who came all the way from Little Rock, Arkansas. Isn't that crazy?
Mm-hmm.
You know?
We had a bunch come from Austin.
Yeah. So, which is great. So, like, you know, I got a few business cards. I handed out a few business cards. And if we even get one job from any of them, we're solid. It totally paid for itself.
Right.
And if not, who cares? You know? We had a really good time. We basically just threw a really badass party.
Right.
Yeah, totally.
And we also have some stuff to put out with BroGraph now, too.
Absolutely. Yeah, totally.
Some really cool content. So.
Yeah. Yeah, reinvest in your own business, like build your website, that kind of stuff, like these dudes be doing.
Mm-hmm. The how do clients react when they know you work from home? Here's what I have to say about that. you know, you don't want to come across as I'm working out of my parents' basement, obviously. Right. I mean, we have a pretty professional operation going from our homes. Yeah. And when I talk about it first, I talk about the fact that, like, I don't say like I work out of my house. I say I have a whole office built into part of my house, like a whole section of my office. Yeah. And then I talk about the fact that right now there's just no point in having that extra overhead for no reason.
Yeah.
And then that makes you sound like, you know, you're cost conscious and they're going to get
a better deal because, you know,
not even a better deal, but that you're not overcharging them for the $500 chair you're sitting in.
Right.
You know, and your special edit suite with, you know, just ridiculous overkill. Right.
Yeah.
The other thing.
I actually had someone, I was talking to someone just this last week about, you know, what we do. And they asked me, you know, occasionally I'll get the question, well, do you have a studio you work out of? And I said, we have a studio we can use if we want, but why waste 2 hours out of the day driving there when we can get just as much work done from home, you know? And we're so efficient. We're working off of Dropbox, so it's almost like working from a central server, you know? So Dave and I, we're on Skype all day, you know, we're talking to each other and we're working, and we don't need to be in the same place. Yeah.
What's the difference? What does an office have?
My answer to those clients is that I'm an artist and I only do art between the hours of midnight and 5 a.m. in my tidy whities.
That's funny.
No, I don't know. I've actually never had anybody ask me that before.
I think Chad talked about this at Half Res, and he said basically the future artist, everyone is going to be working from home. You know, that's where it's going to. Everyone is going to start working from home.
Oh my God.
What?
Dave, that thing that you posted the other day, I was crying, laughing so hard.
Oh yeah.
Should put that in the show notes. Oh my God. The this guy calls 911. It's just a joke thing, but this guy calls 911 because he's working from home, and it's like the 911 person is trying to like, I don't know, Dave, you could explain this better.
What happened?
I'm so good at explaining things. It's just like trying to help him go throughout his day, and it's like, sir, are you, you know, it's okay, calm down, you know, don't, did you have breakfast? And he's like, well, I put the banana in the peanut butter and I ate it like that. And it's like, no, you know, that's not breakfast, sir. It's just, I don't know, it just keeps going.
Did you take a shower today? I don't know. Okay, smell yourself. You smell bad? Yeah. Okay, you haven't taken a shower. Like, it's just this whole thing about working from home. It's too hard to explain. You got to.
It was also really depressing because I so identified with that, and I'm becoming. I think my health is just deteriorating because I like never leave my house.
Same here. It's terrible. I'm having those heart palpitations like all that's the time. That's the caffeine.
It's so bad.
I don't know. Like, I don't know.
I'm just a freaking blob. Here's the thing.
Emma, like, when I was working at a job, you know, I would go to lunch. I would spend my lunch hour and I would go work out. But it's like now I'm like 5 minutes away from my gym. I'm paying a gym membership every day.
Me too.
And I'm not going. I don't want to get up a little bit earlier to take my kid to school and then go to the gym. And like during lunch, it's just like, I'm so close to doing this stuff. I don't want to leave for lunch. I'm just going to stay here and keep working and just grab a sandwich.
Gime. You know. What's a gime?
Emma literally told me that I'm becoming that guy from South Park that's the Warcraft player that's just like sitting there typing. Yeah. Oh my God. Said,
have you talked to anybody today? Oh, in person? I mean, I looked at the mailman through the blinds. Does that count? No, it doesn't.
That's funny. Yeah. That's really funny. You'll have to put that in there. You know, I'm not on Facebook anymore, so...
You're not on Facebook. So dude, above all the politics. Dude, I will tell you,
deleting Facebook from my phone was the greatest thing I've ever done.
I told you.
I go to Facebook. I have started going to Facebook at least once a day, just checking my notifications, seeing if someone tagged me in a picture or someone's asking questions or if we're getting BroGraph stuff or something like that. And it's weird. Mm-hmm. I'll have like 27 notifications and all of it's just boring crap. No offense. You guys tagging me in pictures aren't boring crap, but still, it's boring crap.
Mm-hmm. You're boring crap. Your face is boring crap.
So, anyway.
I don't know, man. I just saw this crazy video of some, you know, those indoor skydiving places?
Mm-hmm. I saw that,
There's some, like, dancer person that's doing mega flips and, like,
I saw
amazing
that on Reddit.
Aerial acrobatics. Whatever.
There's fine. No reason Reddit. I need to be on Facebook because everyone's just posting links from Reddit.
Fair enough. It's all the same crap.
You just want to see it.
And I don't have to deal with my stupid friends and family spouting off all their their politics.
Yeah, that's true. So, next question was, I'm just trying to spur this on.
Let's move a little faster here.
Sorry.
Being a freelancer, would you get a small office space if you could?
Yes. Well, okay. So, if you could, office space... Maybe. Somewhere or office space in your house, because I have an office space in my house, as all of us do. Completely separate room than everything else, and I think you gotta have that, especially if you're a freelancer working from home.
If you don't have a separate room, then it might be a good idea if you can afford it.
But there are always these places that you can get like monthly memberships to. There's one in Dallas called the Treehouse. There's another one down in Deep Ellum called there's a bunch of creative, common spaces that you can you know, go to.
Could be really good to get yourself more focused if you're having issues doing that at home and you're distracted by all the things like I am. Yeah, it could be. And, you know, you feel like everybody else is working and maybe you make some new contacts there, or at least, you know, like get out and actually socialize with people, because you can get pretty lonely and isolated just working from home.
Yeah.
And that happens to me even more now that Emma's job is out. She's out for 4 days a week, just like at a boarding school. So she's just gone for the, for all those days. So I'm just like, you know, what is it? Solitary confinement. I like go out to the grocery store. I'm like, oh my God, you're a human.
Yeah. It's like when I have to go do something, I'm like, you mean I have to put on real clothes?
Yeah.
Jeans.
Got to put on clothes like a poor person.
So the other thing too, is if you can't afford office space and you don't want to get a bigger place or an extra room or something like that, what I like to do is, obviously I can't bring all of my gear to work on the big projects, you know, somewhere else, but what I'll do is I'll save all of my paperwork, you know, like I'll have like maybe Monday morning, okay, I'm gonna do invoicing, I got to do all these email follow-ups, then I have to do this stuff on the website, and it's just all stuff you could do with a laptop. It's not anything you need anything crazy for.
Right.
You could even use like an iPad for, right? And so I'll drop my daughter off at school.
Go to a coffee shop.
Totally. Go to a coffee shop. It's just a change of scene. That's all it is, you know? And then you're not distracted. You can't work on your actual stuff. You don't have the gear. You're just doing your clerical work.
Yep.
It feels so good
sometimes when I like manage to do a bunch of business on the, like, just when someone else is driving and I'm like, you know, answering a bunch of client emails on my phone, like forwarding stuff through Dropbox and like taking care of all the BS that I don't want to do, you know, when I'm actually working, that feels good.
Totally. And that's the thing too, is that being there kind of forces you to do it all at once and hurry up so you can get out of there and get back to your other work. And like, you feel productive for doing that, you know?
Totally.
So, all right. So how do you manage cash flow since every job is different? Would sustainable minimum
You've got a really good way of handling cash flow.
What's that?
That we were talking about.
Yeah. Not
spending it all. No, I spend it all. And then, you know, and then, I just go into debt, and then at some point by the end of the year, usually it evens out.
Yeah, yours is a really risky way of
yeah,
of
no, doing it. do not do what I do. I really need to start saving money. Yeah.
Okay, way Dave and I do it, so when we first started, we had a little bit of capital, very little bit, and we jumped off, it was because we had a little bit of money left over from work that we had been putting into the bank for like 3 years, you know?
Yeah.
We were just letting it sit there up until we made enough capital to where we knew that we could jump off. And so Dave finally made the jump in December of 2015. And then starting January, I think we started paying you or something, you know? And then, but what we decided to do was that we were going to pay ourselves a set salary. You know, look at how much money we think we could make per month, and give ourselves a salary based on that. When Dave left his job, he took a $15,000 pay cut. When I left my job, I took a $20,000 pay cut. But
and it's not even that. Also, we're losing the side income.
We are losing the side income. Yeah, and that was a big thing. You know, because we're so used to getting this extra money every month. It's like, oh, well, I've got this bill due. Well, don't worry, all this other freelance work is going to cover me. But now it's like, now we're just trying to push through and get that bonus money. You know, and we bonus ourselves if we set ourselves, you know, a certain amount that we have to make per month for the business, and we'll bonus ourselves, you know, like $1,000 or something like that. If we hit other, you know, key numbers throughout the month, we'll bonus ourselves some more. You know?
Yeah, it's like every extra $20,000 we make, we bonus ourselves $1,000.
No, it's the first $20,000. We just came up with this the other day. The first $20,000 we get ourselves, we give $1,000, and then for every $10,000 after that, we give ourselves $500
on top of our salary.
On top of our salary, yes.
Right.
Gotcha. So, and which is good. I mean, it worked out really well.
It's motivating.
It is motivating. Yeah, it's for sure motivating, yeah. Especially. Well,
like, but I it's even more motivating when you make a $20,000 job and then you have $20,000 in your bank and then you go take a month off now.
Yeah.
Well, and that's the thing is that all that other money just sits in the company bank account.
Mm-hmm. Right.
It's just locked there.
It's way smarter what you guys do. I'm just
really
saying, like,
good opening up that bank account and seeing like a really high number that just two people made, you know?
Totally.
Yeah. And knowing that you're not frugally or non-frugally spending that, frivolously spending that.
Well, sometimes.
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 You guys do like, some stuff.
If we were dumping all that money straight into our personal bank accounts, it wouldn't be like it is.
Fair enough.
No. At all.
No, so my favorite thing is what Beeple said on, I think, the Twitch live stream. He was like, you know, the more... Oh, crap, what did he say? Now I'm totally failing at remembering. Like, if you want to have time for your art, you need to start viewing money as time, which sounds pretty simple. But like,
it was the live stream that he's talking about.
But like, one way that you can actually give yourself more time to do the things you want to do is by spending less money. And that's the thing that I'm absolutely the worst at. And I don't connect in my brain that if I make this excessive purchase right now, I'm actually going to have less time to make creative art and things that I want to do. I'm going to have less time for tutorials. I'm going to have to take on a bunch of work that I don't want to do, you know? So all of that stuff is interconnected and it's really important to focus on that and be a little more disciplined in that arena.
Yeah. By spending now, you're costing yourself time in the future. You know, I think with that, he was talking about like a car payment or something like that. You know, you go out, you go buy a car, you're looking at how much extra you've got to work per month in order to make that car payment, you know?
Right.
And the really cash flow part of it too, it's like, number one, we pay contractors first before we pay ourselves. And usually that's not an issue. But like, we like to pay contractors almost right away so we don't forget, number one.
But we also you have certain clients that pay you the second they send an invoice, and we are those clients. We like being those clients. I like having really good rapport with the people that are doing work for us, because if they know that we're good for it, they're going to do better work for us, you know?
That's or the even, thing. Like, if,
like not if charge us a few client, hours here and there, you know, and give us a better deal, because they know as soon as they send an invoice, I'm going to pay it, you know?
Well, and when we're working with a client and like we know that they're an instant payer, like we want to get that project out the door because we know it's going to be instant. And the same thing to our contractors, like the more that we the quicker we pay them, the more likely they are to do a good job and get it done. And sometimes I'm begging people to invoice us so we can pay them because I don't want to forget about it, you know. If there's a contractor and like you don't pay them and they're asking you about it and then they're asking you about it again and it's late and the whole thing, they're not gonna want to work for you that much longer.
Absolutely. I really want to drop certain clients because they're so bad at paying and it's just annoying.
It's like you know, like we as a tiny little company are able to pay the day that we get an invoice. Why is it
why can't these big corporations
it gets sent immediately to you know, payroll or paycheck or whatever, and then why can't they just write a check right there? It doesn't make any sense.
Because they like to hold on to the money and work their cash flow, work the numbers, do the whole thing, I understand. But it's all scalable.
It works smarter, not harder.
Every level. Let's see.
Anyway, Dave and I pay ourselves a salary. You know, a set amount per year, and then everything else goes into the bank. So that's
smart.
I think that is the best way that you can be successful. And
just pretend the other money doesn't exist.
It's much harder to do that.
Absolutely.
It's much harder to do that as a solo person though I think, because you guys are
not at all.
Well, you guys are sharing the responsibility and you're holding each other accountable.
Nah. I did 3 months of independent contracting. I did 3 months of independent contracting, and like, it was still easy. I figured out how much I need, and here's the best thing about being an independent contractor for yourself and working only for yourself. If you decide how much you need to make, you go through and you do a budget. A budget is absolutely number one. If you don't have a budget, get a budget. You know, because if you don't have a budget, you don't know how much money you're spending. You don't know how much money you should be saving. You don't know how much money is going to where and where and where. But so with that, you'll actually realize how much money you need to make per year. Set that as your amount.
Right,
and then try and push yourself. Say, okay, when I was working for myself, it was like, I need to make $750 a week was my bare minimum or something like that. Right. You know, which really isn't that hard. That's like a day and a half of like full work, you know, or something like that.
Or just a day, depending on who you're working for.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. So like, you know, if you can knock that out, and you know, my rate was super cheap because I didn't know any better. Mm-hmm. But like, you try really hard to hit those goals, you know, but every extra little bit you put into the bank account, and I was paying myself weekly, which was awesome. Getting paid weekly is the bomb. And like being able to do that, being able to be your own boss, you can actually do that, which is fantastic.
This reminds me, I didn't pay myself.
I know you didn't. You're so awful about it. It's like, how many days into the year and 5 days into the year? I don't know. I'm like struggling to like keep myself above water like days before.
Because I have a sugar mama.
I know you got a sugar mama.
No, it's also because I have a set amount of saved money in the bank.
Yeah.
And like whether or not that other money hits the bank last week or this week isn't going to really change anything.
See, I got a I know. I mean, I got a little bit of money in the bank, which is fine, but I've been taking everything I possibly can and just paying off debt. That's the whole point of living in my parents' basement.
Yeah. So,
one other thing. It's Texas, we don't have basements.
No, but real quick, David, before you hit that, I agree with you with what you're saying though, that the accountability is easier with two people, because I can't go like, oh, you know what? I got a little money in the bank. I'm going to just throw 10 grand in my personal account. I can't do that.
No, because you have to consult with Matt.
I have thought about asking you a couple of times, dude, let's just throw 10 grand into our account. But
and so here's the thing. I don't even have a savings account. All of it just goes straight into my checking account. You know, I'm terrible with money. And so,
I'm the same way, but my savings is my checking buffer.
Man, I kind of have
a number in my head that if I go below it, then like, then I'm in trouble.
Yeah,
you know, I try and keep.
Yeah, I try to set aside at least, you know, a certain amount for the mortgage and for utilities and everything a month. You know, I have to, but yeah, I'm terrible about it, and it all just goes to one place, and I'm not paying myself anything. There's no business account; it just goes straight into my checking. Mm-hmm. And I would say, you know, don't be afraid of Mint.com, and
I hate
look
Mint.
At all of your. You hate Mint?
Well,
whatever.
Hate Mint.
Whatever you use to track your spending, whatever it is that tracks, you know, how you're spending things, that's how you can make a budget. You know, just see how much you're spending every month and try to make targets that are less than that, I guess.
Yeah.
You can manage that stuff in Wave Apps.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Wave Apps is the best invoicing service ever.
I know it's great for invoicing. I just didn't know it was also great for tracking your spending.
Mm-hmm.
I've never used it for that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I just know you.
What do you guys use to track your
spending
stuff?
Just my brain and my bank.
Oh, just
account.
Your brain?
Like, I mean, I just go. I check my bank. I check my bank account every day. I've got
Well, Mint will take in multiple sources, like your credit card.
The biggest thing that I didn't like
PayPal,
about Mint was that it doesn't know, like, if some little, you know, taco vendor off the side of the street, you know, you charge your card on that, it doesn't know that that was spent for food. It just sees it as a miscellaneous charge or something, you know?
Yeah, it can suck at categorizing them, and you do have to put some effort into going in and
I don't want to put the extra effort into categorizing everything when I can just go through my bank account.
But it gives you really good analytics month to month on what your spending has been, and you can see like where there are peaks, and you're like, oh crap, you know, apparently May is like a bad month, you know, a month where I spend like crazy or whatever it is, you know.
Huh. Yeah, I tried it for a while. I just didn't have the discipline to do like what Matt was saying, to go in and do all these individual.
But even if you don't if you don't categorize it, you can still see an overall raw, like, you know, pie chart of of whatever, and or like just month to month spending is very useful to know. Mm-hmm. You know, like, and then it just tallies like, oh, this is how much I spent in a year. Holy crap, I'm an idiot.
I kind of go with the whole, you know, I know
this is how
about
much Starbucks I've spent.
Yeah, exactly.
I know how much that it usually costs me for bills and stuff every month. And so I kind of just dedicate a paycheck to that and just know that the first paycheck of the month just doesn't exist.
Right.
In other words, you know, that covers everything.
Yeah, that's actually my wife's paycheck. Like, my wife. Ah, there
my
it was.
Wife. Drink.
No, her paycheck doesn't exist, basically. It doesn't go. Mm-hmm. It only goes to pay bills, you know, and debt. Because, I mean, that's all we're trying to do. My paychecks, they go to pay, you know, bills and food and lunches and whatever, you know. But hers all goes to pay debt.
Yeah.
Which is nice that you can put... And she only gets one paycheck a month because she's a teacher. So it's right. Nice being able to put an entire paycheck towards debt.
So let's move to these other questions here mm-hmm. before we get out of here. This is Tom Heathrow who says... Hey guys, I have what I thought as a pretty basic. Okay, this is we're switching to like C4D stuff here.
Sweet.
Pretty basic C4D question. I can't find an answer anywhere. I've been searching all over, and I can't find anything. So hopefully we can maybe help. So I have a poly that's 64 by 64 centimeters that is stacked in a column of five polys,
mm-hmm.
and then it extends horizontal and makes an arc. Just picture an H.
Yeah, I can't picture it. Poly that is stacked in a column of five. Stacked in a column of five polys? Mm-hmm. Oh, wait. One, two. Okay. And then makes...
Okay, and it makes an arch like an H. I'm displacing it with the cell noise shader.
Mm-hmm.
How do I work out the scale of the noise shader in centimeters?
No idea. Dave?
I'm not sure I even understand the question.
Yeah.
Maybe he's trying to do accurate, like, you know, in your noise shader, you've got certain centimeters or whatever, and he would expect that to correspond to the centimeters inside or with of the polys or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, how do you map that one-to-one? And I have no clue
one
either
the,
because
the
I never measure
things
I just, like, do it to taste, you know, like,
yeah.
mess with stuff until it looks good.
Yeah, it's kind of crappy that you can't see displacement. Can you see displacement as, you know, when putting it on there immediately, or do you have to render it out?
You can now, I think, in the new Cinema,
is this,
right?
Okay. Is this even talking about the displacement deformer? I guess
displacing
it is.
Displacing it with the cell noise shader.
Yeah, so he's using a displacement deformer, and then in his noise, he's got the cell noise, mm-hmm. you know, type. Yeah.
He said, I'm changing the global scale to match it up to the size of my model, but it's fiddly and not accurate.
Right.
Is there any way to determine the physical scale of a noise in centimeters, not just a percentage?
I don't
think so. Oh,
so
like global scale set to 100.
Right.
I see.
I don't think
so.
You
might just have to figure out those ratios yourself.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, 1 centimeter would be 100%, and... you know, half a centimeter would be 50%. I don't know another way to do that. And I wish we had more info. Or, you know what, send us like a picture or something so we can have a better visualization of it. I think it's really hard over text and audio to figure mm-hmm. that out. He said, we'd love your perspective and thought this might be a little topic for the podcast to listen every week. Cheers, Tom.
Cheers.
Man, that's tough.
Probably something technical.
That's funny.
Man, that's a real tough... Give us some more information, and we're going to circle back around to that.
Mm-hmm.
Because it will make more sense, I think, if we see it. Let's see. We got an alternative deal from called AnyDesk for... We were talking about having
a
video solution.
No, I think AnyDesk is like...
Like TeamViewer?
Yeah, like TeamViewer.
Oh, a Skype alternative would
Discord.
Be called Discord.
Discord?
That mm-hmm. sounds familiar. Oh. I don't think I've tried it. We'll check that one out. We're still working on it.
Because we just tried out,
solution.
What was it that the other person said?
Zoom.
Yeah, zoom.us. And we used that. We tried it out right before this one, and it didn't work.
Well, it seemed cool. The only reason it didn't work is because, it didn't work because we were doing a weird audio setup here with, and it was really echoey. And I was doing, getting the whole speech jam thing where I was like, "Hey guys, I can echo hear myself."
But it also costs money.
Yeah,
like it's every user is like $15.
$15 per user per month, and that's a little outrageous. You know?
I'm looking for free video streaming services, so maybe Discord will be good. Gaten D. Simone said, "Hey, bros, I thought of two topic ideas for your podcast. I've been putting together a new portfolio site for myself."
Should we hold off on these since we're already 90 minutes in?
Did we already talk about this? I think maybe we talked about this.
I don't know. Yeah, I think we hit this one first and then we left off the other one last time.
We did.
Time. Yeah.
We did talk about this. All
right,
last
go
time.
Team.
Right. Glad we could answer that license. One so quick. Yeah, let's talk about your Houdini license issue.
Houdini. Okay. First off, have you guys seen the introduction to the new Houdini 16?
Yes. Yeah, it looks amazing. I mean, Houdini's always been amazing.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, yeah, those tools are too cool for me. It's too hard to learn that. Goodbye.
No way. I'm dealing with fog. All right. So you and I, David, have been playing around with fog a lot. You so much in your music video that you just finished up and looks amazing. Me, I've been playing around with fog because I want to understand it better. And like, I just wish there was a way to create, like, take an object and turn it into fog. You know, like they can with cycles. I think cycles can do that, right? I wish Octane did that. So I'm like, I put myself, and you know, I'm moving everything over to my PC because my PC is going to be my main computer now. My Mac is just, you know, it's what we record our podcast on. It is now a podcast catcher, but a really expensive podcast catcher. So, I'm moving my Houdini license over, and I'm trying to get everything like hooked up to where I can work because it was originally on my Mac. And so, like, supposedly all you're supposed to do is open the Houdini like administration license thing and like right click and say release license. And I tried that, and it wasn't working. So finally, I was like, all right, I'm gonna call them. So I called him, and it was so weird. The girl answered, and she's like, "Yeah, just send me the list of what it says in your dialogue." Okay. Well, do you want to stay on the phone with me real quick? I got a client standing right next to me. Okay. I'm sorry to be an inconvenience to you. So I sent it off. She said, "Okay, try this." So I tried that. Nope. And we went back and forth where I would send her the new dialogue. And then she would give me a new update. We did this for 2 days. 2 days trying to get to release the Houdini license so that I could put it on my PC. And I said, "Can't you guys just see that there's a problem and then just release it yourself?" Nope, sorry, we cannot release the license on our end.
And like, part of the problem is I think your host name changed.
Yeah, something happened. Like, I don't know, maybe I was using 2 Mac Pros or something, or 2.
Yeah, okay. And you remember, like, have you ever had this problem with your Mac where all of a sudden it will say like your Mac 2, and then next day it's your Mac 3, and the next day it's your
probably,
Mac 4.
I think that's probably what happened when I was setting up the initial Houdini license and stuff. It was Mac Pro 2, but then once I went through and, like, you know, renamed everything and blah blah blah, it was not easy. I then had to go into the host file. She's like, "Just go into the host file and change this." And I'm like, "What the heck is a host file?" You know, so I had to Google that, look that up, and finally, you know what? It all came down once we did all these changes was that when I was typing in stuff, it just needed to be capitalized instead of lowercase. Jeez. Yeah,
the host file is pretty interesting, but you can do some fun stuff with it. You can redirect websites if you can get into somebody's host file and change like google.com to like, you know,
goatsy
or something. Yeah, you're gonna really mess with some people.
It's funny.
The main thing to me though, it's like, you know, what if something happens to your computer, or you know, you just have to reset it, and then you have no way to release the original license.
Yeah. What happens if your computer catches on fire? Are you basically
your SOL?
That doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense that they couldn't release it off on their side.
you know?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So anyway, I finally get it installed, and like I have determined that this week, during any free time that I have, I'm going to be doing Houdini tutorials. And I'm sure that will probably last through one tutorial, and I'll be like, screw this, I'm just sticking with
Sam. Oh, I should send you my giant folder of Houdini tutorials that I'm never going to watch.
Yeah, you should.
Because I sent that to the dude from Glass Hand Films, Brandon Clements, who I talked to online for a while. He's super nice. Because he was looking to, you know, learn Houdini. I'm like, all right, well, I bought all these things on FXPHD back in the day, and I was intending on watching them, but they're serving no purpose, and FXPHD doesn't even have them on their site anymore.
Oh, really? So, that's funny. Yeah.
They've got some, but not the whole collection. He's learning. Yeah.
Oh,
I don't know. It's going to take, it's longer. It doesn't happen overnight, Matt.
Yeah, see, that's the problem. I need it to happen overnight.
No, that's not going to work with Houdini. I'm sorry.
Yeah, you know, the thing, I didn't know about your New Year's resolution. You didn't tell us about that. Oh, yeah,
that's right. I thought I did, but
yeah,
my New Year's resolution is to watch a tutorial every day.
Yeah.
And I'm up to 38. I've been going strong.
Nice.
So I've been, you know, scouring the internet for new stuff. And also just, I've got so much in my tutorial banks to watch. And I've got a new tutorial hero, got a new tutorial crush.
What's your
Daniel Danielson? You guys mentioned him on the that is his real name.
Sir, can I see your license? Oh, I don't have my license. Then what's your name? Daniel Danielson.
Anyway, so yeah,
it's like Mario. Like, Mario.
This cannot be Mario, this Mario? Guy's real name.
What's your name?
Yeah. Luigi. I'm David Mario. Davidson. Yeah. Yeah. You're Matt Madison.
It's like Bodie McBoatface. Bodie McBoatface.
Dave Daverton. Anyway, so like, yeah, I was like, this cannot be this guy's real name. It's just a joke he's playing on people. But on his YouTube page, it's like, actually, yes, this is really my name, guys.
Is he
but he just has, I don't know. But he has the most entertaining tutorials I have seen since Andrew Kramer. I'm so glad you pointed me to these, because they're not only are they good, or not only are they entertaining, but they're actually really good. The end result is really pretty to look at, and did things with deformers to make my brain explode.
That's the guy who we posted the one about the glass shattering.
The glass shattering.
Right? Yeah.
Yeah. He's got one about jellyfish that's like the coolest way I've ever seen to animate jellyfish. Just cool. Like almost automated using some spline in, I don't know what deformers, I forget, but yeah. And I don't know, it just made me crack up at so many points. He's like, at one point he's like, now we're going to lay the out of it. I don't know. Yeah. It's just like really funny. Like it's just great. And it's really high production value too. Like there's like these epic intros and to everything and random jokes, you know, sprinkled throughout. So yeah.
That's cool. So that's been your favorite so far. What is favorite tutorial that you would recommend to everyone?
Oh crap. I mean, probably
Burgraph the ones.
Yeah. the ones from several years ago. Yeah.
How's that tutorial you're working on? You know the ones you've been working on?
It's funny.
I don't know. Probably Beeple's live stream, honestly.
Just that one was pretty good.
Really fun watching him work. I also saw David Brodeur's, thing for Motionographer where...
Yeah.
It's the step-by-step thing, and that's really cool because I kind of just want to watch more artists work because they don't necessarily have the time to sit down and like go like break everything down and be like blah blah blah, this is what this button does, you know. They just work, and you can glean so much information from the way that they're doing what they're doing, so that would be really cool. Yeah, my other thing that I've been watching a lot is actually Blender Guru, which is the dude Andrew Price from Polygon, who started Polygon. Oh. He's got amazingly popular tutorials online on YouTube for Blender, but the things that he's doing totally apply to Octane. He's like painting displacement maps in Photoshop to create snow, and it's much more up my alley, like with like trying to create a little bit more realistic type stuff versus like constantly seeing spheres and things moving all around or whatever you know the popular thing to do with MoGraph world is. So it's more geared towards creating building scenes. He's got like one to build Mars and build all these, you know, paint rock faces, like sculpt, you know, cliffs and stuff. I'm like, oh, I want to make that. I want to make a cave. Yeah, I want to make a snowy scene, you know. So that kind of stuff is really cool, and that knowledge totally applies, especially if you're using Cycles, you know, because it's literally the same renderer. The same.
You haven't played around with Cycles yet?
Not yet. But I'm jealous that it can do volume, you know, just do volumes out of any object that you've got. And it's, you know, amazing for X particles. You can like tell it to get brighter based on speed and all of these crazy controls for X particles. But yeah, Blender Guru. I don't remember what else I've watched. Yeah, those are the highlights for sure.
I got a link, by the way, for a really cool tire. This is just completely random, but somebody posted this in the Facebook Octane group this week, and he didn't have any good like old school tires with the white writing on them and a, you know, cool rim, and so he made this Octane like displacement and all, it just all the bells and whistles tire, like really really detailed tire, and he put it out there for free, so we'll have a link to that as well.
Sweet. You guys also need to check out Daniel Danielson's reel, because like, you know, a lot of times tutorial guys, their stuff won't be that good, but his reel was like one of the best edited reels I've ever seen. It was just like, it felt like the music was made specifically for his reel, like it was scored to it, but it wasn't. He was just, you know, really smart about editing. So and his stuff is really different and weird, which I liked. I don't know where this guy came from. So I've got a bunch of links about different scan sites that I thought I'd talk about, 3D scans, because people, you know, like I feel like 3D scanning is totally the future of CG. Like those, you know, the most amazing daily renders you see are often people getting 3D scans from places.
Yeah,
you know,
totally.
Using those, you know, mega scans all over the place to create digital nature. So it seems like, so there's one I saw on the Blender Guru site is called Rock.
Yeah, I'm looking at it right now. Rock. That's pretty crazy.
Yeah, it's called Rock Essentials. So it's scans of 500 different rocks, and some of them are massive structures. So like they've actually built and sculpted like huge, you know, structures, or maybe they scan them. I'm not really sure, but the rocks definitely are scans. And then they're actual brushes in for Photoshop to
import the photo into some photo scanning software and let it magically create a mesh out of thin air. Jeez.
That's like what they Agisoft's photo scan.
That's what they're using, but it's a very time intensive, you know, process. So they've done scans of 500 rocks and all of these bigger structures, and they've got rock brushes in Photoshop that you can use to sculpt kind of cliff faces and create your own displacement maps and stuff like that. So that looked super cool. Then there's obviously 1024, which is the 3dscanstore.com, or just actually just www.3dscanstore.com. That's the one everybody uses, like the guy from Shitty Renders, who does amazing stuff with like their people and lighting them, and it's a really good way to start with a base that's like solid, you know, start with something authentic and then use it to practice lighting and shading and all of these other things.
This is great.
Yeah, this is really good stuff.
Oh, you guys are looking at the rocks.
Yeah. I am.
Yeah, it's cool. Let's see what else. 3ddigitaldoubles.com seems to be another competing 3D scan store, and it's cool, you know, you'll get all these different expression packs of people making different faces, so it's a good way to get emotion into your renders if you want people to connect with other humans in your artwork and for it to not be a bunch of soulless CG and just a bunch of rocks.
Oh, cool.
Actually, yeah,
3D scanned heads.
Oh, yeah.
Nice.
And then the last one that people are using a lot is blankrepository.com.
Yeah, which I've seen that.
Yeah, that's for food and all that. Like, and they've the got burger. Like.
That was the one that we posted. It was like
oranges.
The prettiest render of the ugliest burger you've ever seen.
Yeah. Totally. But yeah, like, you know that it's what people are using when, if you look on their testimonials, Joseph Bashara is like one of the first ones, who, by the way, I'm obsessed with his renders. Let me talk about Joseph Bashara.
This 1024 3D scan store are uncircumcised, by the way.
Yeah, man. Dude.
That's funny.
Circumcision has no purpose. Like, it doesn't actually help anything.
Oh, boy.
Here we go.
That's funny.
Yeah.
These are, so I'm looking at the 3D
it's
one.
It's genital mutilation. It's genital mutilation.
I was going to ask you this question. Blank Repository, have they added anything lately? Because for a while, they didn't have anything new.
I don't know.
I think they did something just lately where they added a couple of more things, but I honestly don't remember.
Vegetable, fruit, bread, and processed food. Now, see, that's all they have. That's
yeah. Well, it's still really good. Lots of people want to make some fruity scenes.
It's great, but like they haven't added anything in at least a year, I think.
Yeah, okay. Maybe. I got another one. So this is no longer 3D scan stuff. It's someone gave out a free 10 cloud VDB pack.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, so they just put that on their Travis on YouTube Davids. Or whatever. Yeah, he's been releasing a couple Octane tutorials, and he just went into Houdini and created a bunch of different clouds and
See,
released
that's
that.
What I want to do.
Yeah, though you can also just, you know, my presentation's going to be up in a couple weeks, and you guys will, you know, put that up, and you can totally make clouds without without the VDBs. You can just use your default noises in C4D.
Yep, totally.
Oh, yeah, totally. And then if you do want to do them in Houdini, we posted that one last week on how you can do it. I've gone through and done clouds in Houdini before. It is not that difficult. If you know anything about nodes, you're fine. So.
Man,
Travis Davids is good. This is good stuff.
Yeah, it's good stuff for sure. What else was I going to say? So I came across this short by Chris Bier. I don't know how to say his name. This is the guy that works with Ash Thorpe to do. He did None with Ash Thorpe, which was all the buildings and the fog, which looked really cool. And then he did Epic, you know, the space one with all the planets and amazingness that was like 12 minutes long. So I looked at this guy's work. I was like, you know, who is this guy? Because Ash apparently likes him, and I looked at his stuff on Vimeo, and I was blown away. There's this one short called Void, which is just some of the most detailed and crazy art-directed stuff I've ever seen. And his process reel was even more mind-blowing. Like, the motion graphics he created at, like, some 10K resolution, and it's just, like, some of the most complex After Effects layering stuff I've ever seen, all to go on these little computer screens, and I'm just like, what?
That's funny.
You know, so you should super check out this breakdown.
Wish I had more time for all of this.
Yeah.
Oh, to like just sit there and watch stuff like I do and procrastinate. Yeah.
And to build stuff like this though.
Oh
like,
yeah, yeah.
You know, I mean, nobody's gonna pay me to do this stuff.
Well, you know.
Yeah, we need a passion project. I think that's really what we're missing in our life is a passion project.
Here's what a lot of people do is they will save up money. And by a lot of people, I mean the people that get really good at this stuff and are smart will save up money and then go on sabbatical. You know, meaning they'll be like, I'm going to take this next 2 or 3 weeks to learn hard surface modeling and grind on it every day. And I'm paying myself to learn this stuff.
Sure.
You know, and creating a big passion project, I think, is a great way to get work that looks like that passion project. Like, that's what I'm hoping to do with my music video is kind of propel myself forward to where I'm getting hired to do more 3D jobs and less editing, color grading, visual effects, DIT, BS. You know, I really want to do the high-end 3D stuff. So I'm hoping that that will get me noticed to some degree and then allow me to, you know, it's like Beeple is successful because he has created his version of art, like what he likes to do. And then he's managed to sell that to people, you know, so all of these touring visuals people and all these big artists will come and say, we want you to make more stuff that looks like your stuff, you know? And that, so that's like, that's the dream is when you've got clients coming to you to make stuff that looks like your own creative vision. So yeah, that's
cool.
Yeah.
The breakdown for this video is really great.
It's sick.
I want to sit and like break it down, and it's like you said too. It's so great to be able to sit and watch somebody. That's why I kind of just like I try and post time lapses of things sometimes if I'm working on a big project, because like I know there's no way I could ever sit down and make a tutorial on a 3 or 4 day project I worked on. You know, it's just impossible, but at least I could put it out there and people could like pause it and, you know, maybe get something out of it, you know, at some point. My stuff's not that complicated, but for somebody who's just getting into it, it might be helpful to and for valuable to be able to watch, you know, how that's done. So I put it out there for that reason. Mm-hmm. And I love watching like time lapses that other people have done, the breakdowns. Just put it all out there, you know, don't edit it at all. Just put a huge long, you know, totally long raw feed out there, and people will watch it.
Totally. The last little note I had for something that I saw that was amazing, and I totally geeked out on this guy's Vimeo and like had this long conversation with him about like how amazing his work is. Oh my god, I totally fanboyed all over this guy. I don't really know how to pronounce his name. He works at, you know, Man vs. Machine, which is one of the most amazing companies you can work at. Michael Markzewski, I guess. Okay. Anyway, this guy got a Vimeo staff pick, which is why I came across him. I think I sent you guys this stuff.
I hope you get a Vimeo staff pick.
That would be nice. I don't really know how people go about getting noticed by Vimeo.
I'll work on that for you, okay?
Oh, yeah, vicious cycle. Did we talk about this on the show, or did you just send this to me?
I sent that to you guys. I don't think we talked about it. So I love this video.
Did you send this to me? And you did it in Skype?
I think so. You may not have seen it, but...
it's in the notes.
Okay.
He did this all with Dynamics, and it's these different machines going through these... Like, this guy's been doing these contraptions as his, like, personal art for a really long time. And it builds and builds. At first it's like, oh, I love watching all these crazy contraptions. And then it eventually evolves and gets faster and faster and more chaotic.
Oh, yeah.
And then it turns into this horrific like scene of robot decimation and violence. This guy's got, it's got such a
10% of them is going away. Right. Is that what that means?
I guess you're right. Maybe I used that wrong. But I love his sense of humor in this and the storytelling and kind of the progression. Mm-hmm. And then the other one
this
is Night Rush.
Reminds me so much of that one, this vicious cycle one reminds me so much of the, remember it was like almost like a jukebox or something built of like all these little repetitive little motions and stuff. And they just took all, I don't know. It was some music video. Gosh, it was beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, sorry.
That's okay.
I know what you're talking about. Mm-hmm. I was looking for that the other day, and I could not find it.
Yeah, I don't remember what
EJ
it's called.
Posted it.
I don't really know.
Sorry, David. Go ahead.
Oh, that's okay. The other one is called Night Rush, so it's also on his page, and it's got a very different look. It's all Arnold, though the first shot is V-Ray, and I could totally tell that it was different. I was like, man, that first shot does not look as good as the rest. So apparently he did it all in V-Ray and then went back and redid the whole thing in Arnold except for the first shot, because he was getting such better like volumetric lights and kind of, you know, dusty, foggy lighting out of Arnold. There's this one moment with a skull roughness map, which I just thought was such a good idea.
Mm-hmm.
And I love he sells.
Yeah, that's cool.
He sells, like, he's got this old film, like all these film overlays and nasty stuff, but he really sells like these impacts, right? So there's this one moment where these shields come up and they do this complex thing and slam onto the ground and the camera shakes. But at the same time, he has the film overlays emphasize the hit. So when that last hit happens, like the film dirt gets more intense. And I'm like, wow, you know, there are just so many subtle details going into this. And so I just, you know, really geeked out on his work.
Oh, yeah. Asked, like, that's pretty cool.
Yeah. And somebody asked, like, how long did this take? This one took him like 6 months, you know? So it's like, that's like your, you know, your usual kind of timeline for such a big passion project.
Did I mention that I was able to try out V-Ray, the new V-Ray for C40 3.4?
Oh, yeah.
With the GPU stuff. I got to try that out this past week. And I didn't hate it, you know? Because I've been, I worked
a ringing endorsement.
Well, here's the thing. Like, it took him so long to release this. You know, he had been talking about this forever. And, you know, I really feel like Chaos Group should keep it in-house instead of outsourcing it to someone else. But whatever, that's my own personal opinion. But it felt pretty, like, it felt familiar, is what I'll say. Is because, I learned V-Ray 1.9, and I was on V-Ray for a while, a really long time. And I grew to love V-Ray.
And so it felt familiar going back and kind of nice.
Totally.
And with the interactive preview renderer and stuff like that, it was actually pretty snappy. It wasn't too bad. So anyway, cool. So I'm not gonna hate so much on V-Ray anymore.
All right.
Because the V-Ray will no longer receive
Matt's wrath.
Yeah, no longer receive my wrath.
Yeah.
It's funny.
So I confirmed, this is just a random note about Octane, but I definitely finally confirmed, and you guys saw this in my presentation, that the larger your light is, the fewer samples you need for it. And I also wanted to talk about how people a lot of the time don't know what the light samples actually do and that it's a ratio. Maybe we've talked about this several times before.
Yeah, we've mentioned it once or twice.
But
it's such a hard concept to get your head around, you know?
It is. Like, and the thing that makes me really think that people, like, so looking at Beeple's live stream, and I don't know if he still does that, and obviously I'm not trying to bash you, dude, but, like, you're the best of the best, and if you don't know this specific thing, then nobody really does. So I see people, like, going in and maxing out all of their light samples. They just want all the samples. You know, they click... and I'm talking about not your max samples, but your individual light samples. So if you've got several area lights, you know, you've got your light tags, and you can go in and set your max or the samples that you want to be attributed to each light. And I see people going and selecting all the tags and then literally maxing out the number of samples for all the lights so that they're all at 10 million. And that actually doesn't do anything. It doesn't, you know, it's no different from having them all at 100 because it's actually the way it's calculated is a ratio of each light to each light. So you want to go in and isolate each light and figure out which one is causing the noise. So one will typically be noisier than another, whether that's because it's an emission texture or bouncing in a weird way or doing something weird. I don't know. Mm-hmm. But you figure out which one's noisy, and this is like the best way that I've found to optimize my scenes and the noise in my scenes with Octane is by then, you know, adding in orders of magnitude to that light. So if it's really noisy and it's at 100, you set it to 1,000, see if things are more balanced now.
Yeah,
you go
that to gives you a 10-to-1 ratio on everyone else.
Yeah.
You know?
Exactly. Yeah, so, and I also definitely, like, pinpointed that the size of your lights, as long as surface brightness is ticked, which, you know, surface brightness means that it's a physically accurate light, so that the more you scale it up, the brighter things will get. So if surface brightness is ticked and you've got a massive light in your scene and you've got another light that's really small, the really small light, because it's such a smaller percentage of surface area, I guess, will cause a lot more noise because its contribution is being perceived as much smaller. So in that case, you want to set the smaller light to have a lot more samples, and that will clean up your scene.
Cool.
And also there's the whole thing about lights that are not in view of the camera. And if you're having trouble, especially like animated stuff, right? So you design a room and you've got a couple lights in the back and some in the front, and then you move your camera over to another area and you're like, man, this is just so grainy. Well, those samples are being used in the back of the room where they're not even affecting anything your camera's looking at. So keep that in mind. Sometimes you can't, sometimes you have no control over that, you know, but sometimes you do. Like if your camera passes something that's lit like way in the back and then you come around to another area in the room, you could like slowly fall off those lights to zero. And once they hit zero, I believe it's not calculating samples for them anymore.
Yep.
And so that'll really help.
Totally.
Cuckoo.
So, Matt, did you have more stuff you wanted to talk about? I finally released the video, as you guys said.
Yeah, you did.
I probably did it on the wrong day. I probably should have released it during the week. Because it seems like interest is already kind of falling off.
Nah. But wait for tomorrow.
Yeah.
Okay.
You know,
I mean, it's already kind of fallen totally behind in the Octane group on Facebook, but I don't know. Maybe I'll give it a bump. I don't know. All you have to do is comment, and then it'll pop back to the top. So you guys can be my wingman.
That's how stupid Facebook works.
Yeah, that's how stupid Facebook works. Because Reddit is more of a calculation of like some kind of more complex calculation of like upvotes and comments and likes and whatever. I guess there are no likes on Reddit, but you know what I mean. So yeah, I posted on several Reddit or several subreddits, the C4D one, and then animation and, you know, computer graphics. And yeah, I'm getting lots of really positive responses. Yeah, the only negative.
Oh, what, you got a negative one?
What's a negative one?
Oh, yeah, I got several people, and this is kind of to be expected, that are saying, you know, beautiful visuals, but the story's kind of lame. Like, there's not a good story. And it's true. I'm like, yeah, you're right, dude. Like, I hacked my way through this story, and I made it up as I went, and I tried to, like, you know, like, mush it into a way that it sort of felt like something cool is happening, but it's not, you know. And I mean, like this. I don't want
to. Last week I asked RemindMeBot to remind me of this 7 days later. RemindMeBot sent me a reminder 2 hours ago. Perfect timing.
Yeah. So people, that's the thing that kind of put pressure on me, is like when I posted it on the C4D subreddit the first time, people started using this thing that I didn't even know existed called RemindMeBot, which basically would send them a reminder in a week, because I was like, I'm going to release this in a week. And I was just BSing. I didn't know when I was going to release it, but I was like, all right, I guess I'm releasing it tomorrow. And I didn't tell the director because I'm a jerk. I just like put it up there, and he's never going to know. Like, he's, you know, unless I put it on like all over my Facebook and stuff. So I'm not doing that yet. I'm waiting for them to release it, but it's a totally different crowd. Like, I'm trying to appeal to the nerd crowd, you know?
Right.
But yeah, so the funniest response I thought I got was, and the thing I was saying about story, it was definitely part my fault in that I just like jumped in, you know, and started making things without actually sitting down and really trying to figure out a story. At one point I wrote a story, and it was going to have a clone of this guy's self, and they were going to meet up. Like, he was going to be all lonely, and his mm-hmm. reflection was going to be singing to him in mirrors and puddles and stuff. And at some point this other ship was going to arrive with a copy of himself, and then they were going to be singing to each other. And yeah, like Moon, and they're going to be singing to each other, and their reflections were going to be in between them, and the two spaceships were going to be lined up, and it was going to be all symmetrical, and mm-hmm. then they were going to do a spacewalk and, like, I don't know, disconnect each other in like some kind of emo suicide thing, and then go spinning off into the galaxy together.
Then have the director, some awesome space sex. Space.
Well, hilariously, the director actually said that he didn't want the artist to think that we were trying to say that he was gay. And I'm like, are you serious? Is this really, like, like, it's himself, first of all, so that would just be masturbatory. Like, you know, it's just like, anyway,
it's funny.
There's some major, you know, homophobia going around. So I just kind of gave up on that story entirely. And, you know, the whole time the director was like, dude, it's a music video, you know, whatever. And like, I would be like, when we created that, that, you know, scene where he's in frozen in the ice, there's a dude frozen in the ice or whatever. I'm like, all right, director, who's this guy frozen in the ice? He's like, I don't give a crap about that. I'm like, what? Come on. I'm like, are we going to do more story with this? He's like, I don't care. He's just someone to, you know, reverse to cut to. It's mysterious. It's a music video.
Sometimes like, I like a little obscurity, you know? Like, yeah. Let everybody use their imagination.
That's true, but that's also the BS way out, you know?
Well, yes and no. I mean, if you have a little bit of a story, I mean, think about Donnie Darko.
Yeah.
Have you ever seen, not the director's cut, but the original Donnie Darko? Like, there's so much that doesn't make sense in that you're trying to put together in your head. And I don't even know if they had an idea. Oh, they made a sequel years
ago. But, you know, it's so much more interesting when...
Huh. Yeah, they make a sequel.
Yeah, it was, no, they're supposed to be Samantha Darko.
Oh, it was called Ronnie Darko.
I think they're doing another Donnie Darko. I don't know.
It was about his sister when she grew up, and it was awful.
Really?
Yeah, it was really bad.
Anyway,
sorry.
No, it's all good.
Is what you're talking about?
Yeah.
Oh well, never mind.
That's really bad.
I thought they were making like maybe a third one then, Donnie Darko 3.
But you did have a story.
Yeah, but I think it works a lot better when, like, so I think the let the audience make it up in their heads thing works so much better when the people creating the story have a backstory that they just haven't told us. They're like, okay, this is happening and then it becomes internally consistent, and it may go a little bit over the audience's head, but there are rules and there's kind of a reason that things are happening, whether or not you're aware to it. But if it's like the thing that I did, where I just went in like a dumb CG artist and started making cool, pretty things, and then tried to cobble it all together at the end and connect back to the, you know, time that we're in the interior. And I'm like, oh, this is just a flashback, whatever. Then it becomes pretty incoherent. You know, it's just a cool visual space trip, and it exists for that reason as an experiment, but it's not really something that people can really connect with. And so I definitely fell into that, you know, pitfall that so many of these VFX guys and other, you know, CG people trying to make, you know, their stuff, you know, these one man band productions do, is like, I'm not necessarily a storyteller, or I'm not trained in writing. And so I didn't, you know, if I do another one of these, maybe I should pair up with a writer who actually has some good ideas.
Dude,
and I'll just focus on the visuals. Stories. You write stories.
Bro. I do.
Yeah,
dude, I honestly, if I could do anything, it would be writing the stories for everyone else to animate.
Cool. Yeah. I mean, I love that. Yeah. Anyway, this was the funniest comment I got from one of the subreddits. I'm going to say it in an overly technical, nerdy voice. So I had a bit of a disconnect when the relative speeds and panning gave different perceptions to his perceived velocity. Also could not understand for the life of me why he has to fly through insane amounts of debris that he would almost 100% collide with. Then going from a large body like that planetoid before the asteroid belt, then falling towards a star. I'm possibly being too critical here, but I didn't get any story or sense from the visuals, as beautiful as they are.
Are you the creator of High and Lois? Because you're making me laugh.
I'm that really was... happy that I got one of these overly analytical comments, and my response was, fair enough, and the story is lacking for sure. On the other hand, I really don't mind cheating physics and reality to make a piece more interesting looking. I'm pretty sure asteroid belts don't even form torus shapes, that they're separated in reality. They're so separated in reality that you wouldn't even know that you were in an asteroid belt. And if you were in a ring of Saturn, for instance, the particles of debris wouldn't be any larger than a meter. None of that sounds cool visually.
Yeah, and, so. And a lot of this is supposed to be a trip.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So it's like a dream in a dream.
I'm creating my own version of space. And in general, people don't... like, space is easy because, A, people don't know what it is even really supposed to look like that much. I mean, we do for, like...
Space.
Oh, my God.
Space.
We need to talk about EJ. I can never look at my project the same because EJ the whole weekend's been like, space, I'm in space, want to go to space. You know, it's
space,
like...
Space, Bowie's in space.
Suddenly, I'm in space. Space. And just in this totally, like, idiot voice. I love it.
I'm going to recut your video with the Moon Man soundtrack.
Goodbye, Moon Man.
From Rick and Morty.
Yeah, I'm finally watching Rick and Morty now that I'm here.
Like diamonds in your eyes.
Come together.
Oh, the other easy thing about space is that everybody just travels in a straight line, and cameras can just travel in a straight line in one rotation. So I didn't do any fancy camera morphs or anything. I just, you know, it was just like one direction, all linear keyframes, all, you know,
nice.
Except for the dude's movement, which was all vibrate tags, which was,
yeah.
I think that's the thing I'm most proud of, is that like when Lance came up to me afterwards, after my presentation, he was like, you are a cheater. You're a cheater, and I hate you. And I'm like, that's awesome. Lance was so pissed.
In a good way.
In a good way, yeah. I mean, it's true. I'm like, I'm using all Turbo Squid models. Yeah, cutting whatever corners I can to get that kind of complexity for cheap going on.
Yeah, he really enjoyed your presentation.
Sweet.
Yeah,
it was fun.
Word. Anything else?
That's all I got.
Nah, bro.
Let's go watch the Super Bowl.
Ugh, I don't want to.
It might have started already.
Let's watch the Rick and Morty Bowl.
Commercials, dude.
No. Let's put it on a side TV and let's play Halo and Rick and Morty. And that way, when the commercials come on, we just look at the commercials. But the rest of it can just be kind of in the background.
I'll grab this TV.
Dude, didn't you hear they're bringing back Spuds McKenzie?
Are they really?
Yes. And the commercial was awful. It was so bad.
Did it start already?
No, I saw it advertised on Twitter. It's like, hey, I'm Spuds McKenzie. If you don't drink Bud Light, you're not doing me a solid, or something like that. I'm the ghost of Spuds McKenzie. Come on, let's go look at the, I'm the ghost of the future party past, or something. It's so stupid. It's like come on, slurm. You get Spuds McKenzie. You got to stick with like your traditional Spuds McKenzie-esque, you know, party. Yeah, just like the slurm commercials. Anyway.
Space. Yeah, we'll put it on the screen. We'll take some random TVs and we'll just have a LAN party.
I sent my video to Beeple and he was supportive. He's awesome. Whether or not he really thought it was good, he probably thought it was medium. But he was really supportive and he's an awesome dude. I love other, you know, I love artists that are like open to, you know, connecting with others and mm-hmm. you know, don't think that they're necessarily the shit even when they are, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Word up.
Oh, cool, man.
I'm tired.
Yeah. Me too. I gotta pee. I need some food. Yeah. I woke up at like, I didn't eat breakfast until like 11:30. Need to get myself some chicken fried chicken.
Chicken fried chicken.
Oh, yeah, we didn't talk much about
Barton
that.
Damer. Yeah. Oh yeah, we should talk about how we went to
Studio
ABC. Yeah, that's always be
that
jumping.
Studio is pretty sick. I really loved it. Like it.
Yeah.
So
yeah, we all there. We had talked a big about lunch, it now, and we didn't take a dang picture with all of us.
We didn't.
So, no. That's true. Dumb.
It's all right.
Lost our opportunity. Actually, no. We'll do it at NAB. We'll all be there.
Yeah, we will. We will all be there, hanging out and chilling.
That one modeling dude blew my mind with his Iron Man. Whatever, and his custom C4D layout.
Yeah. Over it, already been chewed. He was showing off some
stuff. We didn't
stuff
get to
and,
see
like,
him.
Gosh,
he was at the event.
Yeah, he was.
I saw him,
but we didn't get to talk to him.
They all left before I got to talk to them.
Yeah,
and they were making that really cool custom GPU
rack mount
with the Titan X's.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty cool.
They had some crazy big computers that didn't even fit under their desk, which was really funny.
Yeah. Huge computers.
That's funny. Anyway, all right.
Yeah. Anyway, we're all exhausted.
Yeah.
So you can rate us on iTunes, leave a review, subscribe to us on YouTube and on iTunes. And we got a newsletter out there if you want to subscribe and get updates. You can say you've been there, done that, got the t-shirt with the No Brograph, No Mograph tee. There's the Paul Babb, Feel the Babb 2020 shirt where the profit goes to Doctors Without Borders. We're on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, YouTube, brograph.com, and soon Twitch once we get all of our switching stuff good to go. And man, I think it's time for a Crystal Pepsi.
Yeah.
Sounds great.
Getting crunk up in here.
Or maybe a Miller High Life.
Actually,
we have good beer.
Beers in the fridge, yeah.
We have a lot of good beers. So yeah, we'll probably hit those up.
Cool.
So we're going to fade out.
We're so bro-y right now.
Oh, man. Gosh, whatever.
It's gross. So gross.
All right. Man. Until next week, I'm Dave.
And I'm Matt.
And I'm David.
Have a good one.
Later, bros.
It's pretty good, I guess.
Brograph.com, an online resource for learning critical components of Cinema 4D and After Effects, specifically catered to help you prevail as a motion graphic designer.
What's up, bros? Welcome to another Brograph motion graphics tutorial.
We give you professional time-saving tips, shortcuts, and lessons that help give you an edge over your fellow designers. Not only this, but our new Brograph Talks help you in your file management, hardware configuration, and client relations.
I love projects that scare me. When our art director comes to us and asks for something that I had never done before, man, it gets me pumped.
Join us for live sessions, check out our crazy Cinema 4D experiments, or just watch our Fun with Brograph series, where we show you practical applications for techniques learned in previous tutorials. Do this from the beginning, and your client is going to respect that, and they're going to respect you, and they're going to respect your time. Subscribe today and get automatic updates on the latest tutorials, tricks, tips, and inspiration brought to you by industry professionals Dave Koss and Matt Milstead, all with a slight dash of dry humor peppered in.
Real nice banana.
Brograph.com, your source for tutorials that will help you thrive in the motion graphics industry. Don't just play around with Cinema 4D and After Effects. Master it and make money by becoming indispensable at your workplace.
We don't care how you get here, folks. Just get here.
Subscribe now to BroGraph Tutorials.
It's pretty good, I guess.